All right, Orc Hunters, we're live here on November 15th, 2022. Let's get started here. We're live on Facebook. We're live on YouTube. What a shit show of a day it's been today around the world. Like the video if you haven't. Drop a like on the stream. We're going to be getting right on into it here. Missiles have landed in Poland. The discussion around what's been happening there is a lot of speculation. And we're going to get into everything that's been revealed today on the interwebs and social media. We were live covering the Daryl Brooks trial, and I cut in a couple times with some updates because this is just a huge, huge conversation to have. A lot of the information that we do not have right now, keep that in mind. So it's going to be an investigative stream. This stream isn't going to be, you're not going to find the answer from me, if that makes sense. Okay, I'm not an expert. I'm not a political strategist. I'm not in the rooms that even the Polish government is in right now having discussions, okay? So we're just gonna be reviewing what we're seeing on the internet today, what everybody's been posting, all the speculation we're seeing, what we know right now, what the facts are, and what we're waiting on. We're gonna be going through all of that tonight. Lots of things to go into tonight. Comment where you're tuned in from, what city, what state, where in the world you're watching from. The other thing during this stream we're likely gonna be tuning into at about 8 o'clock Central Time, so that's in a little under an hour, about 50 minutes from now. I think former President Donald Trump is going to be making his announcement to run for president again. So we might be tuning into that for a little bit and seeing the live announcement there. So let's get into it here. This is what happened today from the. This is just a post from the New York Times. Russia-Ukraine war explosion reported in Poland near Ukraine. The government of Poland, a NATO member, held a security crisis meeting. The blast there came as Russia fired roughly 90 missiles into Ukraine today. So that's the other big news, is Russia launched many, many missiles throughout the entirety of Ukraine today. It was a big deal. They do it often. A blast in Poland kills two near Ukraine, and Warsaw blames a Russia-made missile. So here's what it was today. Here's some video I found of the incident from two Polish citizens. Two Polish citizens have died in an explosion near the border with Ukraine, Polish authorities have said. The blast came as Russia fired roughly 90 missiles into Ukraine aimed at its energy system. Kyiv says it shot most of them down. So here's video. It's a short clip. Let me get my headphones on here. What up, Sweden? How we doing? All of our Europe friends that are obviously shook about the situation, but it's important to remain calm during these times. We're going to get into it. We're going to get into the articles of NATO and what all that means here as well. So this is the video of the alleged strike in Poland today that's been posted. The video that shows that the explosion in Przetadał, I'm totally mispronouncing that, in Poland, happened near a storage facility in silos on the village, which is less than 5 miles from Poland's border with Ukraine. Some Polish media and Ukraine alleged a Russian missile was involved, which the Russian Defense Ministry denied. Of course. A second video around the same time from the Ukrainian city of Lviv, 50 miles from Przetadał, showed a different smoke plume rising southwest of Lviv, with Ukrainian territory. Witnesses in the video are describing 5 explosions. So where is this? Where is this real quick? Before we play another video, I want to show you guys exactly where this location is within Poland. Just north of Lviv. You don't have any. Do we have sound in the chat? Let me know. Let me get a yes or no in the chat about sound. So here's the Ukrainian city of Lviv over here in the western portion of the country. And the city in Poland that had missiles hit inside of it is right here. Right here. It's about 50 miles from the city of Lviv. About three and a half miles inland of the country. So here's another video of that from the view of Lviv. Okay, we got good sound.
Там конкретно, і ще з другої сторони десь прилетіло, бо було прильотів 5. Ось мене от тут так
передернуло, бо мені. You can see the smoke plume in the distance. That's the strike in Poland from Lviv. This video is taken in the city of Lviv in Ukraine.
Там конкретно, і ще з другої сторони.
Okay. So let's keep looking here. More articles. Russian-made missile fell on our country, killing two. Poland said early Wednesday that a Russian-made missile fell in the eastern part of the country, killing two people in a blast that marked the first time since the invasion of Ukraine that Russian weapons came down on a NATO country. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky decried the strike as a very significant escalation of the war. Polish Prime Minister Mateusz Morawiecki said the government said investigating and raising its military preparedness. A statement from the Polish Foreign Ministry identified the missile as being made in Russia, but President Duda was more cautious about its origin, saying that officials did not know for sure who fired it or where it was made. So I'm at with this is likely for like the official, we're going to go through the speculation here in a second, but for the official message, it's going to come from Poland, and it's, we're likely not going to get it until tomorrow. An investigation's taking place. They already want Article 4. Let's get into that real quick. They already want to talk about Article 4. NATO to meet on Wednesday at the request of Poland for consultations. NATO ambassadors will meet on Wednesday at the request of Poland on basis of the alliance's Article 4. Two European diplomats told Reuters after an explosion in Poland close to the Ukrainian border, reportedly caused by a stray Russian missile. According to Article 4 of the alliance's founding treaty, members can raise any issue of concern, especially related to the security of a member country. Okay, let's see what the North Atlantic Treaty, let's go to it real quick. So Article 4, let's zoom in. Here's the Articles of NATO. The parties will consult together whenever, in the opinion of any of them, the territorial integrity, political independence, or security of any of the parties is threatened. And I feel like this is automatic at this point, right? You have the war in Ukraine right next door to Poland. You have the war going on right on NATO's border. And this discussion is crucial, right? That allows them to talk right now. It's not Article 5, but even with Article 5, they still need Article 11. All right, Article 5 isn't an automatic in into the war for everyone. Yes, it means if Article 5 is activated after Article 4 takes place. And again, let's look at Article 5 real quick. Let's look at Article 5 here. The parties agree that an armed attack against one or more of them in Europe or North America shall be considered an attack against them all. So this is the big one that everyone's concerned about, Article 5, right? That's the one that says if any attack against a NATO country, it's an attack against the whole defense alliance. So that means that countries will get involved. But that doesn't mean that countries are just going to automatically jump into war. It does, even the United States. It has to go back to the each individual country's governments. So for the United States example, it would go back to Congress. And Congress would have to vote on it and approve that. And that's laid out here in Article 11. This treaty shall be ratified and its provisions carried out by the parties in accordance with their respective constitutional processes. So just because Article 5 gets activated, that means then, yeah, things are going to get serious. I mean, they already are. Hello. We're even talking about it. It's in a serious matter. But yeah, Article 5 is serious, but it still needs to be taken back to NATO member countries and the governments, individual governments. So like for us in the United States, the Senate and the House of Representatives would have to vote on it and approve it. In any other country that you got out there, I'm not sure how your governments work entirely. I'm just learning my own government, to be honest. The instruments or ratification shall be deposited as soon as possible with the government of the United States of America, which will notify all the other signatories of each deposit. So it'd start with us here in the USA, but it still needs to go back to our government. It's not an automatic, like, if Article 5 is enacted, it's not like we're going to just jump right in. It has to come back to the governments. No concrete evidence on who fired missile from Poland's Duda. This is the president of the country. Poland has no conclusive evidence showing who fired the missile that caused an explosion in a village near the Ukrainian border, the president said on Wednesday, adding that Warsaw remained calm in the face of what he described as a one-off incident. Okay, this is coming from the Polish president. I feel that this is in their country. He's the president of the country. They're doing a thorough investigation. Everybody's being very careful right now with how to proceed. Two people were killed in the explosion about 6 kilometers, which is 3.5 miles from the border with Ukraine, firefighters said. We do not have any conclusive evidence at the moment who launched the missile. So this is going to be a multiple day investigation. What you're hearing right now, you're not going to get definitive answer even from me. Anybody claiming that they have definitive proof, unless it comes from Poland tonight at some point, unless the president of Poland and Poland officials come out and make it a definitive answer, which they haven't yet. Nobody knows really who launched the missile, just a bunch of investigations and people that are we'll come back to Article 4, and people that are looking into it. So let's go through some of the speculation that we have seen today, because I'm sure you've seen a lot of it. I'm sure you've seen many of it. Polish journalist claims, this is Polish journalist Mateusz Lakowski, who's got nearly 70,000 followers, doing pretty good, claims that after contacting a military expert, he was informed that the missile fragments at the site of the explosion were of a KH-101 cruise missile. Okay, there are possibilities that the evidence may be skewed, all right, but that's just one of the theories. Here's another one. This was the biggest theory of the day from Ukraine weapons tracker. Very pro-Ukraine. This isn't coming from Russian propaganda, albeit the Russian propaganda is, you know, they're utilizing all of this for sure, but it's coming from sources that are pro-Ukraine and are for Ukraine. So this is a breakdown from the Ukraine weapons tracker Twitter page today. What caused the crash? What caused the crash of the missile? With the cooperation of Blue Boy, which is Neil Gibson, we analyzed the available photos of fragments and came to a clear conclusion that they belong to a 48D6 mortar of the 5V55 series missile of the S-380 system, a Ukrainian one. So let's see what they have to say. Although other missile types also use a very similar design, these aren't available to Ukrainian forces. It's important to note here that this ID is only of this fragment. We can't be sure if nothing else landed or how precisely this happened. So there's the photos of the fragments on the ground. Photos of the missile fragment for comparison. The end seal of the 48N6DM SAMS rocket mortar. As you can see, it is nearly identical to the fragment found in Poland. Of course, the whole incident appears to be a tragic accident. This is posted hours ago at this point. All right, so that's coming from the weapons tracker, comparing it directly to a Ukrainian system. Rob Lee, who we tune into for his postings every day about combat footage, he also weighed in. My understanding is that all S-300 missiles, such as the 5V55 series, were produced in Russia, even during the Soviet era. So the statement doesn't necessarily mean that the missile was launched by Russian forces. As I've said before, like I said, leading into the speculation portion of this stream, we're going to wait till the Polish government makes the official statement. And right now, the official Polish government statements, as we're going through the speculation right now, is there's no concrete evidence. Nothing right now. All right. So again, speculation. This is all people that this is what they do. They're good at open source intelligence and figuring things out. So they're good, reputable sources to go through their analysis. But until we get that official message from Poland, this is all speculation. Here's from Dmytro Kubala from Ukraine. Russia now promotes a conspiracy theory that it was allegedly a missile of Ukrainian air defense that fell on the Polish theory, which is, I'm thinking that this was translated incorrectly, Polish territory, which is not true. No one should buy the Russian propaganda or amplify its messages. This lesson should have been long learned since the downing of MH17, that airliner. Lethal weapon debris collected following the missile strike on the Polish village of Przeczkow, I'm totally butchering that, indicates the Russian KH-101 cruise missile was used in the attack. So we're seeing multiple analysis of both Ukrainian air defense, denial of Ukrainian air defense, some speculation about Russian KH-101 cruise missiles being used and not Ukrainian air defense. Just lots and lots of speculation right now going on in the open source intelligence community. So keep all that in mind. So you got back and forth between those that think it's a KH-101 cruise missile, those that think it's Ukrainian air defense, and that's coming from pro-Ukrainian sources. Regardless, some of the world leaders, Ursula von der Leyen, the president of the EU Commission, stated this. A Alarmed by reports of an explosion in Poland following a massive Russian missile strike on Ukrainian cities. I extend my condolences and my strongest message of support and solidarity with Poland and our Ukrainian friends. We are closely monitoring the situation and are in touch with Polish authorities and partners and their allies. So that's coming from the head of the European Union. Here's from President Biden. Spoke with the president of Poland to express my deep condolences for the loss of life in eastern Poland and offer our support for Poland's investigation into the explosion. We will remain in close touch to determine appropriate next steps as it proceeds. You got people resharing the posting from Ukraine Weapons Tracker underneath. Here's a Pentagon statement from today on the strikes in Poland.
Let me go ahead and highlight up front that we are aware of the press reports alleging that two Russian missiles have struck a location inside Poland near the Ukraine border. I can tell you that we don't have any information at this time to corroborate those reports and are looking into this further. And so when we do have an update to provide, we'll be sure to do so.
Biden has said a few times that the U.S. will defend every inch of NATO territory. If these reports are true, what does that look like for the administration?
Yeah, thanks, Peter. So, you know, as I mentioned, we're looking into these reports, don't have any information to corroborate them at this time. So I don't want to speculate or get into hypotheticals. When it comes to our security commitments and Article 5, we've been crystal clear that we will defend every inch of NATO territory. Thank you, sir.
Hi. So they will defend every inch of NATO territory per Article 5. That was a statement made today. Brigadier General Patrick Ryder, we are aware of the press reports alleging that two Russian missiles have struck location inside Poland. Again, here's the location. That's the location inside of Poland that was hit. I can tell you we don't have any information at this time to corroborate this, the early reports, but they're looking into it further. It's coming from the Pentagon. Okay, this is over here. This is where the strike take place, just north of the city of Lviv in western Ukraine. We'll come back to the Ukraine war map and go through the breakdown for the territorial changes. But the biggest news again today is this missile strike in Poland. From the NATO leader, Jens Stoltenberg, Secretary General, spoke with President Duda about the explosion in Poland. I offered my condolences for the loss of life. NATO is monitoring the situation and allies are closely consulting. Important that all facts are established. Very important. Here's from the president of Poland today. Let me see if my translator bot worked yet. I was asking for the translator bot to translate this for me so we could watch it. I'm thinking it didn't work. I don't know what I'm doing wrong, Discord. We have a translator bot for Twitter videos, and I'm not good at it. I tried twice to get this video translated. Maybe you guys can get to work. Maybe you guys can try and we can watch what the president says. But I have tweets ready from the president in case that didn't work, which it didn't. So let's see what he had to say today. Expressions of sympathy for the closest two of our citizens who died as a result of an explosion, most likely a rocket, which fell on our territory 6 kilometers from the Polish-Ukrainian border. See some more tweets from the president today, president of Poland. I have described the situation to all the leaders. Investigations are underway at the site of the explosion. POTUS declared that he would support us in the form of American experts who would help us in the investigation of the site of this event. So that's good. Sounds like some American investigators are going to be there to help investigate this thing. Again, we're going to likely get majority of the details, or definitely more details, tomorrow. NATO's going to be convening. I have described the situation. I just read that. I apologize. Let's get the next one. We have no conclusive evidence at this time as to who launched the missile. Again, this is coming from the president of Poland. Investigations are underway. It was most likely a Russian-made rocket. Keep that in mind. Most likely a Russian-made rocket. The North Atlantic Alliance is on alert. We have strengthened the readiness of the Polish armed forces, including the air defense. Our planes will be supported by allied planes. We act calmly and prudently. It's all coming from the president of Poland's Twitter. President from Poland, I have informed Jan Stoltenberg, president of the United States, United Kingdom, the Prime Minister of the UK, and Olaf Scholz, that our ambassador will be attending the North Atlantic Council, and that it is highly likely that he will request the activation of Article 4. It's coming from the President of Poland. So tomorrow we're going to have a Article 4 activation, which again, all NATO decisions are made by consensus. So this is the consultation process of what Article 4 is in NATO. All NATO decisions are made by consensus after discussion and consultation among member countries. Consultation between member states is therefore at the heart of NATO, since allies are able to exchange views and information and discuss issues prior to reaching agreement and taking action. So this almost seems like a formality. It almost seems like a formality in this process, especially with Russia's aggressions in Ukraine. No matter what, there's strikes on cities just outside of Poland or just outside of NATO's borders, outside of Poland's borders. This is almost common sense that this is going to be triggered. It's ongoing. Russia's aggressions are inside of NATO's borders now. Consultation is a key part of NATO's decision-making process, since all decisions are made by consensus. It takes place on all subjects of interest to the alliance, including NATO's day-to-day business, core objectives, and fundamental role. Consultation reinforces NATO's political dimension by giving members the opportunity to voice opinions and official positions. So it's going to be debate and discourse tomorrow about what's going to take place next. Also, depending on the investigation. It also gives NATO an active role in preventative diplomacy by providing the means to help avoid military conflict. In Article 4 of NATO's founding treaty, members can bring any issue of concern specifically related to the security of a member country to the table for discussion within the North Atlantic Council. Since the alliance's creation in 1949, Article 4 has been invoked several times. The different forms of consultation. Consultation takes many forms. At its most basic level, it involves simply the exchange of information and opinions. So this is at the root of what Article 4 is and what they're going to be discussing tomorrow. At another level, it covers the communication of actions or decisions which governments have already taken or may be about to take. Finally, it can encompass discussion with the aim of reaching a consensus on policies to be adopted or actions to be taken. So all just discussions with Article 4. In sum, are discussions about what actions to take. In sum, consultation is continuous and takes place both on a formal and informal basis. It can happen quickly due to the fact that all member states have permanent delegations at NATO headquarters in Brussels. Governments can come together at short notice whenever necessary, often with prior knowledge of their respective national preoccupations. In order to agree on common policies or take action on the basis of consensus, the principle of consensus decision making is applied throughout NATO, which means that all NATO decisions are the expression of the collective will of all sovereign states that are members of this intergovernmental organization. While consensus decision making can help a member country preserve national sovereignty in the area of defense and security, Article 4 can be an invitation for member countries to concede this right to the group, or it can simply lead to a request for NATO support. Under Article 4 of NATO's founding treaty, member countries can bring an issue to the attention of NATO. So that's basically what it is. It's going to be alerting NATO, bringing people to the table, and discussing what took place today in Poland. Discussions about what to take place next is what is going to be happening in Poland in NATO's Article 4 discussions. Here's some more from the president today of Poland. All the leaders I spoke with today assured me of allied support, upholding all the provisions of Article 5. We will consider this matter together, which again, Article 5 is the parties agree that an armed attack against one or more of them in Europe or North America shall be considered an attack against them all. If such an attack occurs, each of them in exercise of the right of an individual or collective self-defense recognized by Article 51 of the Charter of the United Nations will assist the party or parties so attacked by taking forthwith, individually, and in concert with the other parties such action it deems necessary, including the use of armed force, to restore and maintain the security of the North Atlantic area. Any such armed attack and all measures taken as a result thereof immediately be reported to the Security Council. Such measures shall be terminated when the Security Council has taken the measures necessarily to restore and maintain international peace and security. So again, Article 5 is the scary one, because that's when all the countries are coming together to take action, including the use of armed force. But Article 5 doesn't, the when Article 5 is discussed and it's like, okay, that's what we're going, it still isn't going to happen until Article 11 takes place and governments, specifically the United States, because that's who it falls onto first, come to an agreement in our individual governments that that's the steps that we want to take. So Article 5 could be invoked and then say, for example, the United States of America says, no, actually, we're voting, we didn't approve that. I don't exactly know what happens then, but I know that they can't just jump into the war at that point in countries, and it's not just going to be like this Avengers article or NATO alliance now just going in and fighting Russia. There's going to be there's a lot of things that take place then, but they just can't jump in and go to war. That's not what happens. Article 11 happens first, and they have to bring it back to the country's individual governments. So here's Russia's official response today, or a couple responses from them, and we'll also go through the latest cult video of the day. So Russia's response from TASS. The statements of the Polish media and officials about the fall of Russian missiles in Poland are a deliberate provocation. The Russian armed forces did not strike any targets near the Ukrainian-Polish border. The Russian Defense Ministry has stated. Also from Simonian. Now Poland has its own Belgorod region. What did you expect? Oh, okay. So the reason that she said that and why she said that Poland is its own Belgorod region now, which again, Poland is in NATO borders. Belgorod's in Russia and it's been hit. Belgorod places in the city, not just Belgorod, but also down here in the southeast, Rostov-on-Don. In Russia have been hit. There's been targets, military targets, infrastructure have been hit within Russia since the invasion. If you're wondering if anywhere in Russia has been hit as part of this war, it has. Belgorod and Rostov-on-Don. So Simonian comparing this portion of Poland to a Belgorod, they're definitely fueling the flames to the fire. I'll tell you that. Definitely fueling the flames there. So here's what happened in Russia on their state TV today. Meanwhile, in Russia, pundits and experts worry about the potential uprising, comparing Russia's current state to 1916 in the run-up to the revolution of 1917. They worry that Russian people are getting more angry and social media is adding to more heat to the growing volatility. So here's Russian cope of the day from their state media.
Если мы ведем войну с НАТО, надо отменять мораторий на смертную казнь диверсантам, террористам, предателям. Кстати, так же, как и вот эти 500-е, которые бегут, как их там называют?
Дезертиры.
По-моему, во всех армиях мира дезертиров жестко приводили в чувство. Поэтому я считаю, что смертная казнь должна вернуться.
I'm gonna be real with y'all. Tonight, there isn't much you can do. Honestly, there's nothing we can do. Poland is invested. This is where we're at with it. All right. People are concerned. I know you're worried. People are nervous, scared. I get it. But things aren't just World War III isn't just going to, I mean, in a sense, it already kind of has started. But in terms of armed conflicts from countries entering like either Ukraine or wherever in the region from NATO, it takes a lot for that to take place, and it's not just going to happen because even if tomorrow Poland comes back with the official that it was a Russian KH-101 cruise missile and it was Russia, or it was a refitted S-300 defense missile, which Russia's already been known to retrofit them to make them into not defensive missiles but offensive missiles, and they've already been known to do that. If that comes out, there still is a lot that's has to happen before the United States enters or any Western country joins the war. We just went into that, what NATO's articles even mean. So I know people are worried, people are nervous. Have a safety meeting. 420 friendly news coverage over here. I'll have one too. We'll spark up. It's going to be okay. All right. It's going to be all right. Investigations are taking place. Article 4 is a good thing. Article 4 is a good thing. It's not the scary one, which is Article 5. But again, Article 5, you need Article 11 still. It's good that they're going to be discussing it. I don't think anyone is against Article 4 taking place and having them all come to the table at least, which should be taking place routinely anyways because of what's happening in Ukraine right next to Poland on consistently. The 60 to 100 cruise missiles just went out throughout the entirety of Ukraine just today and hit Western cities in Ukraine, and it continues. This war is just escalating. It's not diminishing. Ukraine's winning on the ground. They're having success militarily. They're liberating cities within their borders. But Russia's, and you're going to see here in the propaganda that we're going through, Russia's doing everything in their power to escalate it beyond Ukraine. They're losing so bad. They're losing so bad in Ukraine. Their military is getting destroyed. So the only thing they can continue is to just pound propaganda to make it. They've already been framing it as if they're fighting NATO to this point. They're going to continue to do everything in their power to escalate it beyond Ukrainian borders and make it the world's problem. And make in their false prophecy of the world hating Russia, they're making sure that happens so they can continue to promote their narrative and what they want to do, what their goals are. All right, let's get back to the propaganda.
Вернуться в российское законодательство. Она просто необходима. Просто необходима. А у нас выбора нет. Мы обязаны побеждать. Поэтому скажите, что надо для победы. Товарищ генерал-полковник.
Надо, самое главное, не разводить панику. Не рвать волосы на голове и разных других местах.
А на чужой голове можно?
На чужой можно. На чужой можно. Не кричать, ой-ой-ой, все пропало, все пропало. Владимир Владимирович, вы очень верно сказали, что у Запада исторический шанс нами покончить. Но ровно такой же исторический шанс у нас покончить с ними. Надо готовиться к сложным временам, но мы уже это понимаем и их опередили. Мы уже провели частичную мобилизацию. Страны НАТО к ней пока еще не приступали. Поэтому слушайте президента, любите родину, верьте в русского солдата.
Trust in the Russian soldier and all will, so no, absolutely not. So that's what they're telling their people. This is just a big giant shit show. If you've been tuning into my streams every night, I don't have any today. There isn't any new Russian conscript videos to post today, but if they're saying to trust in the Russian soldier, oh my goodness, no. That is the last person you should be trusting into. They don't even know how to fight. They're not to the fault of their own, in a sense, right? They're being conscripted with no training, no equipment, being sent out there, and then their commander leaves them high and dry, and then runs off likely to go set up the next conscript unit to send them at Ukrainian artillery and get killed.
Значение только при одном условии: если мы в зоне специальной военной операции добьемся убедительной военной победы. И все это будет обнулено, все те положительные для нас процессы будут обнулены, причем очень быстро. Тоже при одном условии, если наши замечательные партнеры добьются убедительной политической победы внутри России. И вот, собственно, вот это вот два сценария. Нам нужна военная, у нас антагонистическое противоречие. Нам нужна военная победа, а им нужна политическая. Сценарий 16-го года совершенно... четко имя обозначено. А вы знаете, да, действительно, наше общество наше российское общество, оно проявило абсолютные чудеса психологической и социально-психологической устойчивости, на которые у западников рассчитано не было, и это для них удивление. Но только не нужно думать, что потенциал терпения в обществе, он бесконечен. Оно рано или поздно закончится, потому что Николай Александрович Романов в 2014 году, в августе, он тоже думал, что бесконечно. Ну, во-первых, он думал, что эта война, все думали, что эта война закончится к Рождеству. Вообще ни одна мировая война не начиналась как мировая. Так? И все думали, вот мы к Рождеству все сейчас так быстро, ускоренным маршем, эти на Париж, мы на Берлин, еще куда-то. А вот...
It's starting. I just noticed this guy. We already got it.
Они, например, уже четко готовят.
On the state TV already, full on.
Готовят свое общество к длинной войне. К длинной, тяжелой войне, которую они собираются победить. И мы должны начинать готовить.
Thank you for joining the channel, Sweet Cheeks, thank you.
Наше общество к тяжелой войне. Не к победному маршу. Не к быстрым победам, а именно к тяжелой войне.
Люди, конечно, сталкиваются... вот в интернетах и это вот в анонимном гражданском обществе с любимым восклицанием это глупость или предательство. Оно у нас по каждому поводу, вот это восклицание. Но, наверное, люди, которые приветствуют, оно же такое мощное восклицание. Я вам скажу, уважаемые коллеги, вот с этого...
Is this guy fresh from the front lines or what? What's he trying to do here?
Восклицание господина Милюкова в Государственной Думе в 2016 году... Собственно, это и был сигнал к государственному перевороту. Все его именно так восприняли. И после этого выстроились в одну колонну и пошли прямо к февралю. Именно с этих слов это все началось. А вот, кстати, насчет измены, предательства или глупости, то Милюков, вот он думал, что он не глупый, потому что он сразу стал...
This is another big fact, this is another big point of Russia's propaganda too, is just complete... retellings of history. Like they do this constantly on their news program, on their state media, just revisiting history, history lessons with Russia all the time. And it's just retelling a complete nonsense retelling of historical events. They do this constantly.
Министром временного правительства. И пришли они прямо с ноября 16-го, прямо в февраль 17-го. За два месяца пришли. Материал, субстанция одна и та же с 16-м годом. А инструмент в виде социальных сетей на порядок мощнее.
Товарищ генерал-полковник сказал, что паники он боится. Да нет паники никакой. О чем вы говорите? Есть хуже. Раздражение. А паники нет. Потому что маломальски образованный человек...
Welcome, JK. Thanks for joining the channel.
Человек, который... Гражданин России, который хотя бы читал пару книжек, знает историю. Даже тот, кто читает 140 знаков и думает, что все знает. Он понимает банальную вещь, что нельзя победить ядерную державу. Кстати, как нельзя победить и Америку. Ну, нельзя их победить. Ну, обладатели ядерной державы не проигрывают войн. А вот раздражение, она опасная штука. Очень опасная.
The first thing too that popped into my head, speaking of, he's mentioned nuclear missiles. What's the quality of Russia's nuclear arsenal? Their quality of their cruise missiles and their missile capabilities is clearly terrible.
Знаете, у нас ведь когда объявили мобилизацию частичную, в этот самый момент поменялся общественный договор. А понял ли это кто-нибудь? Или просто объявили частичную и сказали? Ну, повоюем. Нет, раньше общественный договор был, ребят, мы тут рулим, вы все, хорошо, обогащайтесь, значит, ходите в кафе, смотрите кино, кино сейчас, во, масса, хорош, франшиза, все, Человек-паук, все, вы смотрите, ну, боритесь с коррупцией как можете, ну, раз в год с президентом. Пообщаетесь, значит, скажете все, что думаете.
This guy does Hollywood's in the bathroom before news programs. So I if you're wondering, yes, I've been listening to him speak now for at least 10 to 20 seconds, but I haven't really read or it sounded like background noise. He's on that shit, and they put him on the show and they just let him go. Let him ramble and ramble and ramble. That's what they do. плохого. Saying a whole lot of words that really have no meaning.
Он вам ответит. Общественный договор поменялся, как только сказали народу, все, ребят, а теперь туда. Надо защищать Родину. А если это произошло, то ведь это не может быть... Вот я обратился к народу и сказал, ребят, Родина в опасности. И все мы уверены, что мы победим в любом случае. Но мы не победим без мобилизации, как абсолютно правильно было сказано Дмитрием. Тыла и фронта. Не было бы никаких бед, не было бы вот этого раздражения. Почему раздражение? Потому что мне кажется, что власть не во всем доверяет людям, народу. Так что ж мешает-то сказать, дорогой народ, мы с вами, ну были ошибки, ну неправильно посчитали, ну доклады у нас, как обычно, чтобы не огорчить. Ну тут.
Reports were, okay. So we're just, they were miscalculated, so, okay. So he's trying to appeal to the people by also pandering to the government and the Kremlin and openly admitting here they were miscalculated. So this is, he's pretending to be the government explaining their failures to the people, right? So he's even saying here there were miscalculations, their reports were crafted to avoid disappointment. So right there, they say it out loud constantly. They say it out loud, they create shit that isn't true. And to avoid any disappointments from the Russian people or whatever, from the Russian Kremlin and their cope machine.
Обычно, чтобы не огорчить.
Which is typical.
Ну тут проворовался, там проглядел, здесь саботажник. Тогда бы к Херсону бы мы относились бы по-другому. Ну потому что это же следствие тех ошибок, неправильных планов. И тогда у нас будет единство. И тогда мы не будем ахать от того, что да, ушли из Херсона. Ну, потому что так получилось, затормозилось наступление. Наверное, планировали, что все, Киев возьмем через 3 дня. Не получилось. А еще раздражение появляется, потому что ходят же слухи. Вот ушли там, значит, из-под Киева Сум. Ушли оттуда, там, зерновая сделка. А не про бабки ли это? А не будет ли договорника? А может, уже Америка с Путиным договорилась, с нашим президентом? А может, за... Это раздражение копится, потому что ведь изначально от печки со мной честно-то не поговорили, когда уже поняли, что народ-то можно верить. Да не надо думать, что мы все здесь в панику ударимся. Нет здесь паники. Я повторяю это уверенно. У тех, кто может...
Another thing here that, that this is doing too is they're appealing to like an audience, I don't even... like. Because they're just so rooted in their state government and their state media and their control over them. They even play this game here on their media, like to try to position the Kremlin and the people apart from each other, to try to position them as if like they're speaking for the people against the Kremlin. And this is literally an extension of the Kremlin. So they play games. Just it's that would be tough. Being in this and not being from looking at it from an outsider's perspective, because when you're in this propaganda world, they got you believing that this guy would have you convinced that you're even questioning the Kremlin right now, because there's so many Russians that are obviously questioning the goals of Russia and Ukraine at this point. So they're even playing the game of trying to play to the everyday Russian mindset too. And trying to position against the Kremlin, which is all just they're all fabricating it themselves. It's all a fabricated man or created world that they have. That sucks. That's tough. That'd be mentally hard to get out of.
Ответить за слова и выстрелить, если надо, у них паники нет.
А вот насчет сравнения с 16-17 годом, оно правильное и... Но оно не полное. С чего начался 17-й год? 16-го года дискредитация армии. Дискредитация военного командования.
We'll be covering the Trump announcement here in the next 10 minutes. We're waiting for it to start, don't worry. We're covering that.
Деморализация армии. Деморализация общества. Потеря у народа веры во власть. Ну, это сработало. Именно это. А претензии к армии... Во-первых, армия, она отражает то, что есть в обществе. И не ждите, что те проблемы, которые есть у вас в обществе, не проявляются в армии. Всегда, в любой стране, и в моей стране, и в другой. Так что не армия в этом виновата. Такая страна, такая армия.
The way your country is, that's how your army will be. The irony. He doesn't even understand the irony in his own statement.
А с другой стороны, что вы хотите от генералов во время военных действий? Они воюют, каждый как может. Делают ошибки. Каятся в церкви, они не в церкви. Они выполняют свою задачу. Не его задача каяться. Его задача решать проблему. Ошибся, исправляй.
Pre-scripted debates. That's one of their formats too. Sometimes they do go off script though. Solyevov was quiet that whole time, so they stuck to the script this whole program. But sometimes when Solyevov goes off, and it's messy when he does, it looks like they got him back together. He barely even spoke this whole time, and recently he's just been coping, whining, crying, drinking, barely said a word. And usually he's been cutting in with this nihilism, pessimism about the current situation in Russia. But it looks like they got him together. All they had to do was show him a window. Fix that. All right, so that's the Russian cope of the day. Again, we're waiting for Don Trump to announce his presidency. He's running. We got that ready to go. Let me see here. That's going to be a live report. We're just going to tune into that, and we'll come back to what's been taking place in Ukraine. Let me see what we got here. Do we have time to tune in to this video before we continue? Let's not use The Guardian. The Guardian copyrighted me last time. So let's try to find a different link than the Guardian mod. So while we're waiting, here's a UITV report. Russian ammunition cemetery in the Kharkiv region. Tons of iron evidence of war crimes being committed.
A huge cemetery of ammunition that Russia has terrorized Kharkiv with since the beginning of the full-scale invasion had appeared in the city on a site measuring 10,000 square meters. The remains of burned Russian missiles and artillery shells were collected. Its value is currently estimated at more than $100 million.
More than 1,000 of all kinds of fragments were temporarily located in one of the districts of the city. This scrap metal site is unique, they say in the Kharkiv Regional Prosecutor's Office. It is used as a warehouse for evidence of Russian war crimes. Here directly, this is a fragment from a multiple launch rocket system. We see an inscription here. The fuse is inserted. That is, even under such minimal circumstances, the inscriptions on weapon, we can understand the country, the origin of this weapon. It is written in Cyrillic, although Ukraine and Russia use Cyrillic, but Ukrainian markings are carried out in Ukrainian. Almost 90% of what was collected here is the remnants of Smerch, Uragan, and Tornado multiple launch rocket systems.
We're going to come back to this really quick. President Biden is speaking right now. So let's quickly go tune into that. He's live at this moment. I didn't get this link sent to me, I apologize. But here we go, happening now. Let's listen.
There is preliminary information that contests that. I don't want to say that till we completely investigate. But it is...
Sounds like he's talking about Poland.
It's unlikely in the minds of the trajectory that it was fired from Russia. But we'll see.
Thanks, sir. Everybody. Thank you.
Mr. President, is Poland suggested invoking Article 4 or 5 from NATO, sir?
The contest is we're going to probably have a meeting of the ambassadors. So that looks like we're going to go to the next. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, guys.
Meeting of the ambassadors. A meeting of the ambassadors. So that was Biden. Let's see if I can get the replay of that. Let's see if we can watch the replay of that video when it posts. Also, we have Trump announcing here shortly. All right, we'll come back to that. We will return to that. Let me get the full video on that one quick.
With which the Russian invaders fired at Kharkiv citizens every day from July to August. One of the large-scale attacks took place in the center of Kharkiv on September 9th. 14 people were wounded, including 3 children. A school, a kindergarten, shops, a gas station were shelled. Eyewitnesses said that they saw how striking elements of missile flew in.
I turned around and looked out the window like this. It was flashing red. Well, I don't know, maybe while here it flew, I heard that's all. I lied down and I couldn't go any further, and I didn't understand what was happening.
There are not so many remnants of cruise missiles in Kharkiv. At the time of the explosion, the ammunition shatters into small fragments, but there are enough of them in the cemetery to understand with what cruelty the enemy fired at a peaceful city. On August 17, 2022, the dormitory was hit by an Iskander cruise missile. 19 people were killed, more than 20 were wounded. Residents of neighboring house told how civilians were killed in front of their eyes.
We even saw how this rocket flew. It flew very low because we live on the 8th floor. We thought it would hit our high-rise building. Well, it didn't fly from Belgrade. We saw how it flew, and this is it. It's just some kind of horror.
All fragments of ammunition are already safe. They are used in Ukrainian courts by prosecutors and investigators, spokesperson of the Kharkiv Regional Prosecutor's Office says. International experts and criminologists also came here in search of evidence that it was the aggressor country that carried out numerous attacks on Kharkiv. Also, this ammunition can be used and will be used in an international criminal court, in the tribunal, as an evidence base. All of this will not be necessary to move to The Hague, but I am sure that as samples, examples, certain parts will also be sent to the necessary countries for judicial examinations. As long as the investigation continues, the Russian ammunition cemetery will not be closed. Moreover, there is more than one such location in Kharkiv, and for security reasons, the remnants of other shells, such as S-300 missiles, are stored elsewhere. In total, since the beginning of Russia's military invasion of Ukraine, more than 5,000 criminal proceedings have been initiated in the Kharkiv region for violation of the laws and customs of war, the regional prosecutor's office said. Over 8.5 months, more than 1,500 people were killed and more than 2,500 were wounded from the terrorist attacks by the Russian Federation in Kharkiv and the region.
So that's what's going on in the east. Massive ammunition dump. So we have more even about Ukraine that's been taking place in the country. And I'm going to do a map breakdown too as well. There's just so much coming out about Poland and the latest. I have the rest of what Biden had said that was just posted, so we can watch the whole video from President Biden. We're also waiting for Donald Trump's White House or presidential announcement that's about to take place here. So let's listen to what Biden had to say about today's events in Poland.
As you saw, I just met with the leaders of NATO and the G7 and talk about the latest events in Europe. And I briefed them on my discussions with President Duda of Poland, as well as NATO Secretary General Stoltenberg. And we agreed to support Poland's investigation into the explosion in rural Poland near the Ukrainian border. And I'm going to make sure we figure out exactly what happened. Our empathy simply goes out to apparently 2 people were killed. And then we're going to collectively determine our next step as we investigate and proceed. There was total unanimity among the folks at the table. And we also discussed the latest series of Russian missile attacks, which are continuing the brutality and inhumanity that they've demonstrated throughout this war against Ukrainian cities and civilian infrastructures. And they've been totally unconscionable, what they're doing. Totally unconscionable. And the moment when the world had come together at the G20 to urge de-escalation, Russia continues to, has chosen to escalate in Ukraine while we're meeting. I mean, there were scores and scores of attacks, missile attacks, into Western Ukraine. We support Ukraine fully in this moment, and we have since the start of this conflict, and we continue to do whatever it takes to give them the capacity to defend themselves.
Mr. President, is it too early to say whether this missile was fired from Russia?
All right. So that we'll come back to that in a moment. Why are we watching this? Because he's the president of the United States and we're in a NATO country. What are you on? Why are you making us watch this? Listen, I don't give a shit about your personal dislike for Biden. I didn't vote for him in 2020. I voted third party. I don't give a shit. He leads the United States right now. If this guy wins in 2024, we're going to have to listen to what he has to say. So let's listen. And of course, the feed doesn't work properly.
USA, 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 USA.
Well, thank you very much. And on behalf of Melania, myself, and our entire family, I want to thank you all for being here tonight. It's a very special occasion at a very special place. You and all of those watching are the heart and soul of this incredible movement and the greatest country in the history of the world. It's very simple. There has never been anything like it. This great movement of ours, never been anything like it, and perhaps there will never be anything like it again. There's never been anything to compete with what we have all done.
Thank you. What's that?
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, and my fellow citizens, America's comeback starts right now.
Well, thank you, David. Thank you for the $50 super chat. Just announce it, Donald.
2 years ago, when I left office, the United States stood ready for its golden age. Our nation was at the pinnacle of power, prosperity, and prestige, towering above all rivals, vanquishing all enemies, and striding into the future, confident and so strong. In 4 short years, everybody was doing great. Men, women, African Americans, Asian Americans, Hispanic Americans, everybody was thriving like never before. There was never a time like this. We turned the page on decades of globalist sellouts and one-sided trade deals, lifted millions out of poverty, and together we built the greatest economy in the history of the world. When the virus hit our shores, I took decisive action and saved lives and the U.S. economy. And by October of the same year, America was roaring back with the number one fastest economic recovery ever recorded. How about that? All of the incoming administration, and all they had to do was just sit back and watch. Inflation was non-existent. Our southern border was by far the strongest ever. And because the border was so tight, drugs were coming into our country at the lowest level in many, many years. Importantly, after decades of rising energy costs, the United States had finally attained the impossible dream of American energy independence, which soon would have turned into energy dominance.
Dominance. Energy dominance.
For the first time in memory, China was reeling and back on its heels. You've never seen that before, because the United States was outdoing them on every single front, and China was paying billions and billions of dollars in taxes and tariffs. The farmers know that because they got $28 billion of it. No president had ever sought or received $1 for our country from China until I came along, and we were getting hundreds of billions of dollars. Many people think that because of this, China played a very active role in the 2020 election. Just saying. Sure, that didn't happen. Instead of jobs and factories leaving America for China, they were for the first time ever leaving China for America.
So we're China's the narrative now for 2020? I thought it was the machines.
Businesses were pouring back because of our historic tax and regulation cuts, the biggest in both categories in history, bigger even than what Ronald Reagan was able to produce, and he produced a lot. China, Russia, Iran, and North Korea were in check and respected. They respected the United States, and quite honestly, they respected me. I knew them well. The vicious ISIS caliphate, which no president was able to conquer, was decimated by me and our great warriors in less than 3 weeks, and al-Baghdadi, its founder, was hunted down and killed. North Korea had not launched a single long-range missile since my summit with Chairman Kim Jong-un nearly 3 years before. We developed a relationship, and that's a good thing, not a bad thing. It's a good thing, very good thing, actually, because look at what's happening today. My opponents made me out to be a warmonger and just a terrible person who would immediately go into war. They said during the 2016 campaign that if he becomes president, there will never be a war within weeks, and we will have wars like you've never seen before. It will happen immediately, and yet I've gone decades without a war, the first president to do it for that long a period.
You were president for 4 years. What do you mean you went decades as president? What are you talking about?
The world was at peace. America was prospering, and our country was on track for an amazing future because I made big promises to the American people, and unlike other presidents, I kept my promises. I kept them.
I wish he would have did the two hands. The two hands drink is best when he goes like that.
Thank you very much. Under our leadership, we were a great and glorious nation. Something you haven't heard for quite a long period of time. We were a strong nation, and importantly, we were a free nation. But now we are a nation in decline. We are a failing nation. For millions of Americans, the past 2 years under Joe Biden have been a time of pain, hardship, anxiety, and despair. As we speak, inflation is the highest in over 50 years. Gas prices have reached the highest levels in history and expect them to go much higher now that the strategic national reserves, which I filled up, have been virtually drained in order to keep gasoline prices lower just prior to the election. Joe Biden has intentionally surrendered our energy independence. There is no longer even a thought of dominance, and we are now begging for energy help from foreign nations, many of whom find us detestable. Our southern border has been erased, and our country is being invaded by millions and millions of unknown people, many of whom are entering for a very bad and sinister reason. And you know what that reason is. We will be paying a big price for this invasion into our country for years to come. Hundreds of thousands of pounds of deadly drugs, including very lethal fentanyl, are flooding across the now open and totally porous southern border. The blood-soaked streets of our once great cities are cesspools of violent crimes, which are being watched all over the world as leadership of other countries explain that this is what America and democracy is really all about. How sad. The United States has been embarrassed, humiliated, and weakened for all to see. The disasters in Afghanistan, perhaps the most embarrassing moment in the history of our country, where we lost lives, left Americans behind, and surrendered $85 billion worth of the finest military equipment anywhere in the world. And Ukraine, which would have never happened if I were your president, are something.
Here we go. I was waiting for something about Ukraine. Yeah, because, anyway, I'll just let him speak and I'll talk after.
And even the Democrats admit that. That's something I've seen them admit over and over again.
What?
But our enemies are speaking of us with scorn and laughter and derision because of those two events. But there are many more. Even just today, a missile was sent in, probably by Russia, to Poland, 50 miles into Poland, and people are going absolutely wild and crazy, and they're not happy. They are very, very angry.
Why is he
so
quiet?
Now we have a president who falls asleep at global conferences, was held in contempt by the British Parliament over Afghanistan. Thanks to the words of wisdom, he said thank you to the wrong country for inviting him to a major summit on the environment of all things. They fly for days to get there, and then he calls the country a name that was actually a country on another continent. And he's leading us to the brink of nuclear war, a concept unimaginable just 2 short years ago. You cannot mention the nuclear word. It's too devastating. The Green New Deal and the environment, which they say may affect us in 300 years, is all that is talked about. And yet nuclear weapons, which would destroy the world immediately, are never even discussed as a major threat. Can you imagine? They say the ocean will rise 1/8 of an inch over the next 200 to 300 years. But don't worry about nuclear weapons that can take out entire countries with one shot. Something is wrong with their thinking. Under Biden and the radical Democrats, America has been mocked, derided, and brought to its knees, perhaps like never before.
Have we?
But we are here tonight to declare that it does not have to be this way. It does not have to be this way.
So it's America's fault for Russia's invasion of Ukraine. Okay.
2 years ago, we were a great nation, and soon we will be a great nation again.
We're just waiting for the announcement part of this. Just announce
it. The decline of America is being forced upon us by Biden and the radical left lunatics running our government right into the ground. This decline is not a fate we must accept. When given the choice, boldly, clearly, and directly, I believe the American people will overwhelmingly reject the left's platform of national ruin, and they will embrace our platform of national greatness and glory to America. Glory. Exactly 1 week ago, our citizens voted in the important midterm elections, and despite a ridiculously long and unnecessary period of waiting, far longer, in fact, than any third world country, just a short time ago, the Republicans won back control of the House of Representatives.
Why does he sound like he's whispering? He's not as thunderous as he usually is.
And it was with a great Trump-endorsed candidate, Congressman-elect Kevin Kiley, who is a fantastic person. A fantastic person. And I'm very happy it was his vote that did it. But we now won back. This happened just an hour ago. Much criticism is being placed on the fact that the Republican Party should have done better. And frankly, much of this blame is correct. But the citizens of our country have not yet realized the full extent and gravity of the pain our nation is going through. And the total effect of the suffering is just starting to take hold. They don't quite feel it yet, but they will very soon. I have no doubt that by 2024, it will sadly be much worse, and they will see much more clearly what happened and what is happening to our country, and the voting will be much different. 2024.
The voting is going to be different because of the installed people that you're trying to
work on? Are you getting ready? And I am too. I do want to point out that in the midterms, my endorsement success rate was 232 wins and only 22 losses. You don't hear that from the media. And this is an elegant night and an elegant press place, and I'm not going to use the term fake news media.
He's awake.
So we're going to keep it very elegant. But you don't hear that from the media. But I think you will, because people are starting to see what happened. That's some score. And in the primaries, was 98.6%. But they were still trying to blame me. And the reason for the success and that unprecedented success rate is that the Trump administration changed our nation on trade, on securing the border with the strongest, safest border ever in the history of our country, on Islamic terrorism. We had practically just about, not that I can think of, no Islamic attacks, terrorist attacks during the Trump administration. And in fact, we got along very well with the various countries.
Is the border safe or not? He just said they had the safest
border. Including coming up with the Abraham Accords. That's a great thing, the Abraham Accords. But it's because of cutting taxes and cutting regulations at the highest level ever and on building the greatest economy. Any time in the history of the world, there's never been an economy like we had just 2 years ago. Despite the outcome in the Senate, we cannot lose hope. And we must all work very hard for a gentleman and a great person named Herschel Walker, a fabulous human being who loves our country and will be a great United States Senator. Herschel Walker, get out and vote for Herschel, and he deserves it. He was an incredible athlete. He'll be an even better senator. Get out and vote for Herschel Walker. We elected a group of incredibly talented America First leaders who will be stars of our party for many years to come. In the popular vote, another thing that's not discussed for the House, we must remember that Republicans won 5 million more votes, the largest margin in many, many years, over the Democrats. 5 million more votes, that's a big thing. Breaking the radical Democrats' grip on Congress was crucial. So in other words, because of our great congressmen and all of our great congressmen and congresswomen, we have taken over Congress. Nancy Pelosi has been fired. Isn't that nice?
Pretty sure she's still going to be the House Minority Leader.
I told them, I said, if you just keep a little bit lower standard, you're going to have a big victory. They said, let's win by 40 seats. Let's win by 50. I said, if you win by 2 seats, be happy. But she's on her way to another country right now. She's been fired. But we always have known that this was not the end. It was only the beginning of our fight to rescue the American dream. And it's a word you don't use. Two words. I don't want to be Joe. It's two words. American dream. That was not good what he did. There are a lot of bad things, like going to Idaho and saying, welcome to the state of Florida. I really love it. In order to make America great and glorious again, I am tonight announcing my candidacy for President of the United States.
There it is. All right, he announced. He kind of just snuck that in there. Like, there wasn't even a lead into it. He didn't have anything prepared. He was just going out there and by the way, I'm running for president. Biden doesn't know where things are, and oh, I'm running for president. All right.
So many incredible friends and family here tonight. It's such a beautiful thing. It's some people say, how do you speak before so many people all the time? If when there's love in the room, it's really easy, if you want to know the truth. It really is. You ought to try it sometime. Together, we will be taking on the most corrupt forces and entrenched interests imaginable. Our country is in a horrible state. We're in grave trouble. This is not a task for a politician or a conventional candidate. This is a task for a great movement that embodies the courage, confidence, and the spirit of the American people. This is a movement. This is not for
any one individual. Reviving it.
It's a job for tens of millions of proud people working together from all across the land and from all walks of life, young and old, black and white, Hispanic and Asian, many of whom we have brought together for the very, very first time. If you look at the numbers, if you look at what's happened with Hispanic, with African American, with Asian.
He's already said this.
Just look at what's happening. This is a party that has become much bigger, much stronger, much more powerful, can do much more good for our country. This is a job for grandmothers and construction workers, firefighters, builders, teachers, doctors, and farmers who cannot stay quiet any longer. You can't stay quiet any longer. You're angry about what's happening to our country. Our country is being destroyed before your very eyes. It's a job for every aspiring young person and every hardworking parent, for every entrepreneur and underappreciated police officer who is ready to shout for safety in America. The police are being treated so badly. These are great people. They can straighten out the crime. They're the ones that know how to do it. We have to give them back their respect and their dignity.
Oh, God.
This will not be my campaign. This will be our campaign altogether.
Stop it, dude. Oh, my God. Oh, no. It's your campaign.
Because the only force strong enough to defeat the massive corruption we are up against is you, the American people. It's true. The American people, the greatest people on earth. We love them all. And we love both sides. We're going to bring people together. We're going to unify people. And it was happening in the previous administration, previous to the previous, and what was bringing them together was success. Prior to COVID coming in, the people were calling me, that were calling me, you wouldn't believe it. People that were so far left, I figured they'd never speak to me and I would never speak to them. But our success was so incredible, like never before. And then COVID started coming in from China. We call it the China virus. Some people call it other things.
2020 greatest hits.
It was devastating, and we built it back and did an incredible job. But when people say Republicans or Democrats or liberals or conservatives, I say we can all get together. And we were doing that. That was happening just prior because the success was greater than this country has ever had. We were leapfrogging China and leapfrogging everybody else, and everybody wanted a piece of it. But just as I promised in 2016, I am your voice. I am your voice. The Washington establishment wants to silence us, but we will not let them do that. What we have built together over the past 6 years is the greatest movement in history because it is not about politics. It's about our love for this great country, America, and we're not going to let it fail.
All right. So he announced, I think we can move on now. All right. We're good. We're good. He officially made his announcement. I don't need to hear anymore. All right. He's just going to continue on political messaging and pandering. So let's get back to the Ukraine war. We're waiting for that big news. He talked about Ukraine there for a second. Let's just recollect ourselves. Recollect ourselves. Comment we were watching from. Spark went up. There's a 420 friendly live stream over here. Trump announced, and we're going to see what's going on. I put a poll up in the chat. Do you think Trump's going to run against DeSantis? That's going to be some good content. I'll tell you what. Trump versus DeSantis, especially those debates. We'll be covering debates in 2023 next year. Shit. Damn. Yeah, we'll cover presidential stuff again. I'll cover debates when that time comes, but I think it's going to get interesting for the Republican Party. And the reason we tune into that often is because a lot of the Republican, not people, not the voters, are clearly supportive of the war, are supportive of supporting Ukraine. But the politicians right now, some of the younger, some of the House of Representative Republicans, some of the MAGA wing Republicans aren't, they're actually more supportive of Russia and what's been going on within Ukraine. So it's important to keep out and keep in mind of that. So the latest in Poland today in Ukraine, here's what we know. The government of Poland, a NATO member, held a security crisis meeting. The blast there came as Russia fired roughly 90 missiles into Ukraine aimed at its energy system. So that's what is what happened today. The latest, again, is going to be they're going to be meeting on Wednesday, which is tomorrow. They're going to be meeting tomorrow, and they're going to be likely discussing Article 4 of the NATO treaty. Right. Again, Article 4, all NATO decisions are made by a consensus after discussion and consultation among member countries. Consultation between member states is therefore at the heart of NATO, since allies are able to exchange views and information and discuss issues prior to reaching agreement and taking action. Now, I know what Kadyrov trying to say when he's saying don. Don. But right now, again, the official message from Poland, which is important to keep the eye on. We're following all the world leaders, making seeing what they're saying, and the presidents of these countries. But right now, from Poland, no concrete evidence as to who fired the missile. Let's just Google Poland real quick. Let's see what's going on, if there's anything latest. I have plenty of videos still to go through and some more content. But here, Poland blast may not be from Russian missile, Biden says. And that's what we were just listening to before the Trump speech had started. We can actually go back to that. Let's actually go back to that real quick. Someone had complained that we were listening to Biden talk. We're listening to him talk because he's the president of the United States, and we've already learned that a big portion of NATO's invoking of Article 5 and Article 11 and joining any global conflict is based upon the United States and the government of the United States. So that's why we listen to Biden talk. I don't care if you don't like him or not. I didn't vote for him. I voted third party, so it's not like I'm simping for the man anyways. So please vote for Biden. I don't give a shit. It's just he's the world leader. And we have to listen to what he has to say. Just like I had said before, we listened to Trump and his speech. If he, for some reason, becomes the president again of the United States, we're going to have to listen to what he has to say on world issues, or whoever the president is of the United States. We're a huge, important deal to NATO, and we're a huge, important deal to what is going to be the discussion on what's going to be going forward. So let's just listen to Biden. We were interrupted by Trump for a second, but let's listen to what he had to say, and then I'll read that article, because it is the latest on what's been taking place in the country. This is the latest.
No, thanks for being here. I, as you saw, I just met with the leaders of NATO and the G7 and talk about the latest events in Europe. And I briefed them on my discussions with President Duda of Poland, as well as NATO Secretary General Stoltenberg. And we agreed to support Poland's investigation into the explosion in rural Poland near the Ukrainian border. And I'm going to make sure we figure out exactly what happened. Our empathy simply goes out to apparently two people were killed
And then we're going to collectively determine our next step as we investigate and proceed. There was total unanimity among the folks at the table. And we also discussed the latest series of Russian missile attacks, which are continuing the brutality and inhumanity that they've demonstrated throughout this war against Ukrainian cities and civilian infrastructures.
Which, sad, it's like that. I know that the missiles strike in Poland is a huge deal, especially for many West people in Western countries and citizens of Western countries. But the missile strikes across Ukraine is just devastating, and the civilian population that continues to get killed due to military success. Any military success on the ground from Ukrainian troops is responded to by the Russians by killing civilians and destroying their infrastructure. So that was 60 to 100 cruise missiles went off throughout Ukraine today. It just so happened that Poland was a part of that. I think that alone, whether it was, it's going to be, again, investigations going out, whether it was a Russian missile or whatever happened, the fact that even if it was a Ukrainian air defense trying to protect Lviv and remnants landed in Poland, that's enough to talk about maybe closing the air to the west of Ukraine, closing the airspace, having NATO having some air superiority over there, having some fighter jets over there protecting some of the western cities. So if there is a cruise missile strike, they shoot down the cruise missile, move some of the Patriot missiles launchers into Lviv and move it up a little bit, some of the donate some of the systems, some of the air defense systems, something in western Ukraine to protect the border.
And they've been totally unconscionable what they're doing, totally unconscionable. And the moment when the world had come together at the G20 to urge de-escalation, Russia continues to have chosen to escalate in Ukraine while we're meeting. I mean, there were scores and scores of missile attacks into western Ukraine. We support Ukraine fully in this moment, and we have since the start of this conflict, and we continue to do whatever it takes to give them the capacity to defend themselves.
Say whether this missile was fired from Russia?
This was a huge question. This is the one. Are you ready to say that this missile was fired from Russia?
To give them the capacity to defend themselves.
Mr. President, are you ready to say whether this missile was fired from Russia?
There is preliminary information that contests that. I don't want to say that till we completely investigate, but it is... It's unlikely in the minds of the trajectory that it was fired from Russia, but we'll see.
But he said fired from Russia. He didn't say Belarus. He didn't say it wasn't fired from Russian forces. That's the game that they play, right? They're obviously, being the president of the United States, you got to be careful with your words. But he said it wasn't fired from Russia, which, fine. Okay, that's okay. It might not have been fired from the Russian border, Russian land, but also keep in mind that Russia invaded Ukraine from Belarus. My theory is that there's Russian cruise missiles launched from Belarus here to hit some of these western cities in Ukraine. The Russian military staged here. They staged all here north of Kyiv, all here before they invaded. Here's what that looked like. Right, there's where they had staged here in Homiel, and also just south of Mazir in Belarus. Belarus is a proxy for Russia. They just use that country, put whatever military they have. There's all their military airfields that they have in Belarus. So sure, president says, you know, it didn't originate from Russia. All early indications report that it didn't come from Russia. Okay, but it could come from Russian forces in Belarus. He didn't say anything about that. Let's go back again.
Fired from Russia.
There is preliminary information that contests that. I don't want to say that till we completely investigate. But it's unlikely in the minds of the trajectory that it was fired from Russia. But
He even says trajectory and includes that, like it wasn't fired from Russia, but Russian forces are in Belarus firing at Ukraine. Ukraine's actively building defenses on the border to protect Kyiv again, and because Belarus is flirting with the idea of invasion and invading south again. As we speak, Ukraine and the capital city of Kyiv and the Kyiv Oblast, they're putting up defenses.
Thank you, Mr. President. Is Poland suggested invoking Article 4 or 5 from NATO, sir? The consensus is we're going to probably have a meeting of the ambassadors. So that's looks like we're going to go to the next. Thank you.
Okay,
thank you.
Meeting of the ambassadors.
Thank you, guys.
So that was the latest from Biden right before we had cut into Donald Trump's announcement and what he had to say. Let's go here to the other news that had taken place from Zelensky. We will not allow Russia to wait and build up its forces. I am convinced that now is the time when Russia's war must and can be stopped. This is from the president of Ukraine today at G20. There was a G20 meeting of world leaders. Well, and while this was happening, Russia was sending out cruise missiles all throughout Ukraine. And then the missile crisis in Poland that we're talking about took place. It was a shit show of a day today. But here's what Zelensky had to say at G20.
Вітаємо на Балі. Вітаємо в Індонезії. Для Індонезії велика честь гостити саміт G20. Проголошую саміт G20 відкритим.
На нашу зустріч завітав президент України Володимир Зеленський віртуально. Відтоді я хотів би запросити президента України до слова.
Дуже дякую, шановний пане президенте Відодо, дорогі колеги, світова більшість, яка з нами. Я звертаюся до вас зараз українською мовою, але у кожного з вас на столі є наші пропозиції вашою мовою. Це прояв поваги до вас. Щойно я повернувся до нашої столиці, повернувся з міста Херсон. Херсон – це одне з найважливіших міст півдня нашої країни. І єдиний обласний центр, який Росії вдалося захопити після 24 лютого. І ось Херсон вже вільний. Що це означає? Ця визвольна операція наших сил оборони є для України аналогією багатьох битв минулого, які були переломними моментами у війнах. Вони символізували такі зміни, після яких люди вже знали, чия буде перемога, хоча ще й доводилось воювати заради неї. Це як, наприклад, Ді-Дей, висадка союзників в Нормандії. Вона ще не була крапкою в боротьбі проти зла, але вже визначала увесь подальший хід подій. Саме це ми відчуваємо зараз. Зараз, коли Херсон вільний. Щоб звільнити всю нашу землю від рашистів, нам доведеться воювати ще деякий час. Воювати, але якщо перемога все одно буде за нами, і ми в цьому впевнені, то хіба не варто спробувати реалізувати нашу формулу миру, щоб все ж таки зберегти тисячі життів і уберегти світ від нових дестабілізацій? Ось чому я хочу представити наше бачення шляху до миру, як його реально досягти, і не тільки для нас, але й для усіх вас, ваших союзників та партнерів. У своєму виступі у вересні цього року на сесії Генасамблеї ООН я представив українську формулу миру для світу. Якраз тоді, коли світ надіявся на відновлення після...
World hope for... Is there more to that? Well, that's the only clip we have of that. So President Zelensky speaking at G20 today. We had a question. Yes, Biden is there. Putin is not. Putin was not at G20. Claims of Russian missile strike on Poland trigger NATO emergency talks. Let's get what BBC News had to say about it today.
The first time in the Ukrainian conflict, a Russian missile is said by U.S.
Also, if you guys could, on this live video here on Mercado Media, like the video on YouTube. Make sure you're subscribed to our YouTube channel so you get all notifications. It's a 420-friendly newscast here. We try to keep all current events as relaxed as we can. Thank you to everybody sending super chats and super stickers. Don't feel obligated to do so or becoming a member. Just thank you again for your view. But also, just the free thing is just to like the video and subscribe. If you could just do that for me, that's significant. Thank you again so much. Same with Facebook. Shout out to everybody on the Facebook page. Thank you again so much for tuning in. All right, here's the BBC report from what happened today in Poland.
For the first time in the Ukrainian conflict, a Russian missile is said by US intelligence to have landed in territory under NATO protection in Poland. But that report is being strongly contested tonight, especially by Moscow, which says no Russian missile has landed in Polish territory. During the day, Russian forces launched waves of missile strikes across a wide area of Ukraine, with many targeting energy facilities, leaving millions of homes without power. The Ukrainian authorities say that more than 90 missiles have been fired, but more than 70 have been shot down by air defense systems. Now, Ukraine's...
Well, how about that? Aishu just gifted 5 Mercado Media memberships on the YouTube channel. Let's go! YouTube's trying to keep up with Twitch on, like, the... You know, on Twitch, you can do sub-gifting and all that. Twitch has a whole bunch of stuff like that to give to other community members, but that's what YouTube does. So shout out to Nils, got a gifted membership, BME, Anthony, Burdick, Mocha, Meadow, and Frank were just gifted some memberships on the YouTube. Thank you, Andy.
Public broadcaster reported that the strikes had targeted Kyiv and the wider region, as well as Kharkiv, Poltava, Mykolaiv, Dnipro, and several other towns and cities nationwide, a very extensive area. Now, in that new development I mentioned tonight, US intelligence claimed that Russian missiles had hit a farm in a Polish village near the Ukrainian border. That's the village there, and it's right near the border, as we can see. Poland's Prime Minister has convened an urgent meeting of the National Security Committee. So we start tonight with this report by our international editor, Jeremy Bowen, who's in Odessa in southern Ukraine.
In the hours after the missiles hit, it wasn't clear whether the deadly events just inside the Polish border were a deliberate attack or something else.
Perhaps there's the photo of it too, if you haven't seen the picture yet.
It's a targeting error or a missile malfunction. Russia's defense ministry denied any involvement, calling it a deliberate provocation aimed at escalation. Poland's National Security Council went into emergency session. The Poles are coordinating with NATO. Working out exactly what happened is vital. The North Atlantic Treaty says an attack on one member is an attack on the whole alliance.
Because of the seriousness of the situation that we're dealing with, the President has just finished a conversation with the NATO Secretary General. We are verifying the circumstances under which we might invoke Article 4.
It follows a day of missile attacks on Ukraine, one of the biggest since the war began. There were strikes across the country. This was Kyiv. Most of Ukraine's major cities were hit.
That was today. While all of this has been taking place, Ukraine's been getting hammered.
Attacking the infrastructure of a city is a common tactic in war, trying to pressure a government by making the lives of civilians hard.
I am against the war, and people have to remember that you can't give life back. Those children who will never see their parents again, the children who will never be born, a generation is being lost.
Ukraine's President Zelensky called for action.
Firing missiles at NATO territory is a Russian attack on collective security. This is a very significant escalation. We must act. I want to say now to all our Polish brothers and sisters, Ukraine will always support you. Free people will not be broken by terror.
This evening in Kyiv, emergency services were still at work. What happened here and across the country, and what seems to have been a deadly leakage of the war into Poland, amounts to a challenge of the highest order for West.
And that's going to be such a discussion tomorrow, is how much more does NATO want the war to continue to leak out of Ukraine? That's going to be weighed tomorrow. That's why I think Article 4 is the best decision that they can make at this time.
And leaders. The attacks on Ukraine come a day after President Zelensky went to Kherson to celebrate its recapture. He declared that defeat here was the beginning of the end for Russia in Ukraine. The triumphant visit to Kherson was followed by severe diplomatic condemnation of Russia at the G20 meeting. Russia's answer, more likely by design than coincidence, was the day of missile strikes.
Well, in a moment, we'll be getting some response from Moscow and our Russia editor, Steve Rosenberg. First, let's go to Jeremy Bowen in Odessa. Jeremy, can we talk a little about what's happened today and some of the conflicting...
We're going to listen to what these two have to say, because Jeremy Bowen is one of the few reporters that's been allowed with the Ukrainian military with their counteroffensives. And also this reporter here for BBC, he's in Russia. Not many reporters from mainstream media or anybody get to report out of Russia, but he can. So let's listen to what they got to say.
Steve Rosenberg. First, let's go to Jeremy Bowen in Odessa.
Steve Rosenberg and Jeremy Bowen. So Steve Rosenberg's in Russia.
Jeremy, can we talk a little about what's happened today and some of the conflicting reports that we've been mentioning?
Yes. Well, first of all, for Ukraine, it's been a really awful day because of the large number of missile strikes that they've experienced, probably the worst day that they've had with that in that department since the war began. But these incidents in Poland are potentially, you know, really serious. I'll tell you why that is, because as I said in the piece, the North Atlantic Treaty Article 5 means that all members of NATO treat an attack on one of them as an attack on everybody. Now, the Poles have not asked for that to be invoked. They mentioned it in the clip that we had in that Article 4.
And someone just asked again what Article 4 is. Again, Article 4, real quick, is parties will consult together whenever, in the opinion of any of them, the territorial integrity, political independence, or security of any of the parties is threatened. So basically, they're going to sit down and have debate and discourse about what to do next. Like, they're going to sit down and have discussion. That's what Article 4 is. Official NATO convening of discussing of what to do next. 5 is the decision to take action, but it's still, again, Article 5. After that happens, it still has to go back to Article 11, and it has to go back to each individual country's governments. So even if the representatives at NATO all agree, Article 5, right, which, again, we're already learning isn't going to happen, it's going to be Article 4. Even if Article 5 does take place, it still has to go back to individual governments. Specifically, the United States of America is the driving force of that. Instruments of this ratification shall be deposited as soon as possible with the government of the United States of America, which will notify all the other signatories of each deposit. So basically, if it fails with the U.S. and it doesn't pass the House of Representatives and the Senate, it's likely not going to get approved in any of the other countries either. We're the bastion still, despite all of what we just heard from Don about how America sucks. Whatever. All right, here he is again. Jeremy Bowman.
Article 4 is for urgent consultation, and that, it seems, is what's going to happen. News agencies are reporting in the last few minutes that there is...
Article 4 is a much safer, and you can rest easy with Article 4, right? Knowing that that's a non-military action. It's just discussion. That's what you want. You want that to happen, okay? So Article 4 is a good thing.
Going to be meetings.
As scary as it is, even though articles are happening, I get it. It can lead to Article 5, but you'd rather be seeing Article 4 right now taking place than Article 5. I'll tell you that.
About this in Brussels tomorrow. I think certainly what's going to go on now is a very, you know, exact look at what happened, because the airspace of Ukraine and Poland is very, very deeply surveilled at the moment. So I think technologically they can track where any missiles came from, the flight path of those missiles. And of course, at the site in Poland, there will be missile fragments, and they will be picking those up and taking them away for examination. And that should give good clues as to where that missile came from, because, got to emphasize this tonight, it's quite confused. People do not know where it came from. All kinds of accusations are flying about. The Polish president has spoken to President Biden of the US, and he's also apparently spoken to President Zelensky in Kyiv. So a lot of diplomatic talking, diplomatic maneuvering, consultations coming up, but also, I emphasize again, uncertainty as to what exactly happened.
And that's where we're at. If you're uncertain, so is the powers that be. So is the mainstream power, this BBC. So they don't know what's going on for sure. Again, the official news still is no concrete evidence of who fired the missile. It's all trying to be figured out. Lots of speculation online. Speculation's okay. It leads to discussion and discourse and sometimes revealing of information. A lot of the open source intelligence sources do that constantly, and they do very good at that. But right now, it's still uncertain where the actual origins are. But Biden was very smart in saying it didn't originate from Russia. Likely didn't. If it did come from Russian forces, it Belarus. They've already invaded from there.
Jeremy, thanks very much. All of which takes us to Moscow and Steve Rosenberg, our Russia editor. Steve, what's being said there?
Well, here it's denial. I mean, denial is the knee-jerk reaction of the Russian authorities whenever they are accused of something by the West. And a denial is what we heard this evening in the form of a short statement from the Russian Defense Ministry, which claimed that reports of alleged Russian missiles falling in Poland was not true. It was a deliberate provocation aimed at escalation, the Russians said. The statement also claimed that there were no strikes using Russian weapons on targets near the Ukrainian-Polish border. Although we have heard from Jeremy, of course, about this massive bombardment across Ukraine today. At times like this, at times of crisis, what you need, I think, are channels of communication between the opposing sides. Now, we know that relations between Russia and the West, Russia and NATO, Russia and America are bad. That's putting it mildly. But those channels of communication do exist. Only yesterday, Russia's spy chief met the CIA director for talks in Ankara about how to avoid nuclear escalation in the Ukraine war. So you might expect, you would hope, that conversations will be had between Russia and the West to find out what happened tonight and to avoid further escalation.
You guys think there will be a coup in Russia with the military, or the FSB, I should say, I guess? I think there's a big rift there.
Steve, many thanks again.
There's a big disconnect with official sort, like the Kremlin, Vladimir Putin, the intelligence services, their propaganda.
Steve Rosenberg, our Russia editor.
You think it'll be a revolution? I don't know about that.
Moscow, and before that, Jeremy Bowen in Odessa.
It won't be like a people's, like a coup of the from the people. It'd be like the FSB. You guys saying no? You don't think so? So here's more. Here's some good news. We've been on some downer news about Ukraine and what's been going on in the region. Here's some good news from liberated Kherson residents. Talk about resistance to the Russian occupation and the liberation of Kherson is what we just seen. The videos coming out from down there, seeing the jubilant civilians in the town, seeing the Ukrainian soldiers. We're getting more and more information. Day after the liberation by Ukrainian forces, people of the city of Kherson spoke about what they endured during the so it might not be okay, it might not be like good topics of conversation that they're talking about, but it's good to see Ukrainian forces in the region, and they can actually have these conversations now and tell their stories, because these people, the civilians, weren't able to share anything during Russian occupation. The Russians shut the internet off. They shut any form of communication. So this is the first time that they're able to share their stories, which is more of a positive thing than when they were under occupation. So here's Radio Free Europe about liberated residents in Kherson.
Обзывали украинскими свиньями, было и такое, mm-hmm. да.
Мы. Почему вы нас не любите? Да. Мы же один народ.
Сначала обзывали свиньями, а потом спрашивали, почему вы нас не любите.
Это был март месяц.
He said they called us pigs and then wondered why we didn't love them.
Настроение ноль, ну вы разумеете, да? Кажу, я не могу сидеть. Я говорю, давай так, составим листівочку. Распечатаем и повесим, попробуем. Страшно было. 5 утра мы эти листівочки выехали, развесили по остановочкам.
Мне 42 года, и я выходил в ночи, брал баллон и расписывал там стен. Вроде бы дитяча такая забава, начебто. Люди проходили, и я ж бачу, что люди... И всі радіють, і мені так приємно. Вона така вроде маленька. А знаєте, хотілося побачити, коли ти йдеш, і десь написано там «Слава Україні», ти розумієш, що ми тримаємось, все буде добре.
В Херсоне нет света, нет воды и нет газа. Уже неделю, говорят, их повредили российские военные, когда отходили из города. Несмотря на это, Херсон сложно назвать фронтовым или прифронтовым городом. Здесь идет жизнь, здесь ездят машины, здесь кое-как работает бизнес и даже транспорт здесь ездит. И маршрутки, и автобусы. А время от времени возле дорог можно увидеть вот такие вот сорванные или снятые плакаты времен российской оккупации.
Already say it could take weeks to restore basic utilities.
Чистика я вже можна, ми для технічних нужд беремо.
Некоторые люди купаються,
можна голову помити нормально. Все буде хорошо. Там, ну, говорят, максимум 2 недели. Так що зато вже свободний.
You can still hear the artillery in the background. Locals proudly display the Ukrainian flag. Let's get the Ukrainian flag in the chat.
Що написано?
Що хочете?
Тобі на кофточку не переб'ється?
Не переб'ється, вона чорна.
Ми бачимо не прапори, а ми бачимо це надія і свобода.
Света нет, воды нет, интернета нет. Нам стало намного легче.
Look at that. No electricity, no water, no internet, but we're feeling much better.
Ну, мы здесь, мы, несмотря на то, что всего этого нет, мы улыбаемся, мы ждем, мы радуемся, мы плачем.
So the resiliency here, even while still under a dire situation with no running water, no electricity really, they're just proud, very happy to be under Ukrainian control now, and the liberation's there. And that's south of the city of Kherson that's still under Russian control. We'll get into that during the map breakdown towards the end. I'll do my map breakdown towards the ending of the stream. Ukrainian soldiers jump from tanks and fire at Russian targets. Also, I gotta move up my other stream. All right, so here's from the Sun. The moment, Ukrainian soldiers jump from tanks and fire rockets at Russian targets on the battlefield. Let's see, I don't have any sound here. I'm liking that we're growing our Mercado Media audience on YouTube and Facebook. There's still even a lot tonight too. I love that. Hope you guys come back every night. Cover this war Monday through Saturday. Sundays are my only night off. So if you want to get updated on what's going on in Ukraine and, well, around the world, frankly, because we do world news too now, apparently, come on back. Not too many combat footages posted today. A lot of the video today or the pictures were of strikes on civilians and civilian infrastructure being hit in Ukrainian cities. And then the news of Poland came out and that dominated everything. Of course. Look at this. No audio here, but you can see that's an MTLB. Look at that. Oh, wow. You can see the tracer rounds. Ukrainian soldier using an RPG. Look, probably an RPG 7. Wow, engaging Russian targets. There's a Ukrainian unit here. Look at this. Wow, look at this. They had the rockets on the side. Wow. Let's go back on that one again. So Ukrainian team sees a Russian target in the distance. This is Ukrainians. You already got the rockets out and ready to go. Right on the top. Look at the terrain, y'all. Look at the ground. Look at the mud. this vehicle can traverse that, but some of the Kazovac vehicles they have, because they're Kazovac vehicles, they don't have MRAPs like we did in the U.S. Army. They have some, literally like some, like onesies and twosies. They're just now getting like Caymans and others, but most of their Kazovac vehicles, again, Kazovac is like medical evacuation from a combat zone through on the ground from like a vehicle. Medevac, helicopter, airlift, Kazovac, usually like an ambulance, military, and in the U.S. Army be like an ambulance, but Ukraine's using like technicals. They're using like Toyota Helixes and shit for their Kazovac vehicles. They don't have the capabilities. Wow. So that's a video from The Sun showing some Ukrainians engaging Russians. Here's a good video. Moscow residents on war consequences for Ukrainian civilians. Many Moscow residents who spoke to RFE/RL did not shy away from calling the Russian invasion of Ukraine a war, which is a term banned in Russia by law. Sincerity is a problem in Russia these days, said one person. So let's listen to some Russian opinion here. Mm-hmm. Asking if it's done any good for Ukrainians.
Операция приносит только разрушение в основном. Ну, умирает народ, да, очень много. Русских убивает, считай. Ну, это разрушение, это убийство. Просто из-за того, чтобы американцам там лишний кусок чего-то досталось.
Сложно ответить на этот вопрос. Я там, в общем, в принципе, не был. Вот. Освобождение. Освобождение вот от того, что у них там происходит последние кучу лет.
Свобода на Донбассе.
Свобода, но сейчас там действия опасны, эвакуация идет. Я сам туда еду через 3 дня. Как освободим, тогда будет свобода и безопасность, и люди смогут нормально жить.
Как может хорошо себя повлиять любая война, операция? Как ты назови это? Нету отопления, нету ресурсов никаких. Но живешь в страхе.
Убыток много принесла, и несчастье, горе, и что можно сказать-то?
Это закрытый вопрос, здесь ответ, он очевиден. Про мирных жителей Украины мне искренне жаль, что все так произошло. И мне про жителей Донбасса, которых 8 лет бомбили, мне очень жаль.
И отвечать опасно в нашей стране. Я не знаю, ну зачем это делать. Искренним быть достаточно сложно. Но как бы умные и понимающие люди все читают между строк и так.
Ну ничего хорошего. Если бы меня бомбили, то я бы не сказал, что это что-то положительное.
Some more based responses here.
Жить на мою жизнь. Но Путин так хочет. Вот. И против Путина у вас нет приема, как, так же, как против лома.
О, я считаю только одну разруху. Везде одна разруха, больше ничего. Я так думаю. И в дальнейшем также будет еще хуже, хуже и хуже.
Да я думаю, война ничего хорошего не принесет никому.
Никому она не принесла ничего хорошего пока.
Да ничего она не принесла. Любая война приносит только беды, где бы она ни проходила.
It's done nothing but good. So we got some more based Russian responses rooted in reality. Here's another video, Ukraine's secret weapon, the medics on the front line. So some more around what's been going on in Ukraine beyond Poland. And we'll return to Poland in a second, see if there's anything latest or breaking. I'm sorry, is my limiter on? All right, my bad. I had a limiter now, so it doesn't get that loud.
They are the doctors in the line of fire, battling the daily carnage of war.
My name is Valeria. I am a nurse anesthetist.
Treating the wounded, the dying.
My name is Victor. I am a surgeon.
Sasha. Молодец,
молодец. On front lines where every second counts.
My name is Ruslan. I'm a chief medic.
We're fighting for our land, for our future, for our children. My name is Olga. I am a nurse.
The lives of Ukraine's soldiers are in their hands. They're Ukraine's secret weapon, the medics in the line of fire.
More on the medics. I love these reports on the medics come every now and then, so here's a new one.
For the wheels of war to keep turning, it takes more than just soldiers. Tired army surgeons need to be on call. Nurses, like 21-year-old Valeria, stand by to ease pain and suffering. Each morning starts the same for Nurse Olia. Her daily run, a temporary release from the world this former pharmacist now finds herself in. Here on the Donbass front line, as part of an army medical team. This is the calm before the tempest. And at its centre, Ruslan, enlisted chief army medic. It starts with a hurried breakfast of homemade pancakes before he reports for duty and something of a daily prayer.
As always, I hope for no injuries today, that everybody is safe, well and alive.
But the enemy gives Ruslan and his team no rest. They're in range of Russian shelling.
The reason we've come inside is those are cluster bombs landing all around. Not a huge surprise because they're trapped really between two fronts here. And now they wait and see if there are any casualties.
Ruslan watches and waits and spies on the security cameras an army truck arriving. Outside, the bombardment continues. The day starts badly. The first arrival is beyond any help the medical team can give. We don't want to intrude, so we keep our cameras away.
Men have just arrived in a van from a frontline position. They're asking for body bags. It looks to me from where I'm standing that those were artillery injuries. So this is something that the men really don't like to talk about. They're very willing to talk about the injuries and the people that have been saved, but it's a much more sensitive subject, talking about the dead.
Comrades in arms need to look out for each other. Straight from the battlefield, this man has been peppered with shrapnel. Sergeant Victor is on hand. Valeria, the anaesthetist's assistant, gives something for the pain. The doctors hunt for every piece of Russian metal in the man's flesh. With all patients, time is what matters. He's lucky he didn't lose an eye. In under 10 minutes, the team have him ready for transport.
So Ola is going to be treating the man when he's on his way to the main hospital at the rear. He's going to be okay. You can see that he's walking out of here. This is a fairly typical injury. It's mostly shrapnel that they treat here. There's a lot of Russian artillery coming in, though he was with a minesweeping unit. An interesting thing that these doctors tell us, though, is that since the arrival of thousands of Russian conscripts on this front, they're now treating more Ukrainian soldiers for bullet wounds from close-quarter fighting. This man is going to be fine, and he'll be back at the front before he knows it. There are no recent official figures on how many Ukrainians have been killed or maimed in this war, but it could be over 100,000. Do you know how many patients you've treated since you've been here?
I don't keep the count of these patients. It's a lot. A lot. I've been at war since the 25th of February, so I've had to provide a lot of medical help. But in terms of numbers, to be honest, I don't keep count.
How many patients have you treated so far?
During the whole time? I have to think. A lot. I've seen more than 2,000 people. That's counting the serious and not so serious. That's not only here, but also in Bakhmut and Kyiv region. I really like the solitary lifestyle and this kind of room, far away from everyone. It suits me. I rest and relax after the working day. It helps a lot to just come and flop on the bed and no one disturbs you. I used to be so tired that I didn't even hear incoming missiles when they were falling all around us. I'm serious. I slept like the dead. Even the missiles were not able to wake me up. We were so tired.
Life of a child.
Young ones are the most memorable. Young people who are even younger than me. When someone is dictating the information and there is a date of birth, 2003, and you realize that this person is 18 years old, this person saw very little in life, maybe never even kissed, and already sees death, sees and endures such severe trials. Young people, I'm the most sorry for. I can clearly remember their faces, their injuries. I remember these boys who still didn't lose their fighting spirit. He lays down in front of you without a leg or an arm and jokes with you. You can't help admire this strength.
I consider it my duty to protect Ukraine and to help my soldiers, my people, with what I was taught. I took the doctor's oath to help others. That's why I'm here, for my profession, to give medical help and for the defense of Ukraine.
He was a civilian before, and it's that life, lost to Russia's aggression, that they all say they're fighting for here. It has come to a standstill. Their children no longer go to school, careers and family vacations are on hold. All of Ukraine needs to be protected from this fate. And they've brought more than just their professional skills to the fight. Compassion and tenderness are their war effort too. Here at the front, the nights are gloomier, the shelling relentless, the blackout almost total. And in 9 long months together, far from their own homes, these men and women, strangers before, have become a family, united in common purpose. As comfortable around the dinner table as they are around the operating table. Ruslan's their boss and also chief morale officer. But the team is always at the ready. The surveillance cameras never unwatched. Tonight, Dinner will have to wait.
Gotta roll out.
Another man in need. This critically injured soldier has been struck by what may have been a Russian mortar. Blood and dirt soak his uniform. The whole team is required. This won't be a quick fix. His heartbeat is irregular. And he's lost an eye. His temperature is dropping. The soldier's name is Sasha. Semi-conscious, he reaches for his damaged hand. A finger is missing. He'll need surgery, and they can't do that here. The most difficult part of this job, says Ruslan, is keeping patients alive on the long drive to the main hospital. He and Olya are on hand to make sure that Sasha makes it. There is a heartbeat, and there's breathing, so he's semi-conscious. All's good. All's good. No need to do anything, just calmly lay down. Artillery flashes in the distance. This road too is within range of Russian firepower.
Sasha? Молодец, молодец.
Well done, well done.
I want to say that these soldiers, like Sasha, were driving to the hospital, are defending their own land. The homeland, and we are here to help these people as we can. We are Ukrainians. We want to live in a peaceful country, so that the sun was shining, so that our children could grow up under a peaceful sky. We want this, and we're fighting for our land, for our future, for our children.
It's a long, hard drive for a badly injured man. An hour and 20 minutes since they began treating Sasha, they hand him over to doctors at the main hospital. He's going to make it.
An hour and 20 minutes.
Another soul saved.
Wow.
But the war still rages on, and there will be others. Ruslan's work is far from done.
Only one message comes from here.
Мир.
Peace.
Завжди потрібен мир.
There is always a need for peace. Civilized society, and this is happening. Well, it means it's not civilized enough. I wish we'd learned this faster. All of us.
All of us. Wow. Wow. Report from BBC News about medics on the front line. Heroes. Total respect for the medical staff. Complete and total respect. One more report beyond what's going on in Poland, and we'll return to the latest that's been taking place there and any news that has been updated since we've been reporting on it. Here's from the city of Bakhmut. Right, so this is all in the east of Ukraine, and also I'm going to be doing my map breakdown here shortly, showing what's changed within Ukraine as well. We haven't even done that yet, but this is now in the Ukrainian controlled city of Bakhmut in the east, which is close to us because the 58th Infantry Brigade is there defending the city. So let's see what this video update is about. The city of Bakhmut, frozen life on the edge of war. The war still is going on despite what happened in Poland today. Ukraine did not attack Poland. Stop. I know you came from Redacted or Jackson or wherever, but it didn't happen. Stop it. Look at the destruction. Not long ago, people lived here. Playground. Even need to be said. There isn't even any narration over this. We continue collecting for the DJI Mavic 3 quadcopter and other needs. If you want to join it, there you go. Take a screenshot. If you want to donate to a collection for this YouTube channel, it's called The Flashback. Looks like they're trying to do some reporting in the East, so that'd be good. Flashback, that's their PayPal. @gmail.com. All right, let's return to Poland. Let's return to Poland and what the latest that has been developing in that portion of the country, in that portion of the conflict, and then I'll do my map breakdown. There hasn't been a whole lot of territorial changes in the last 24 hours. Let's go over here to what is trending. Also, comment where you're watching from, what city, what state, where in the world you are tuned in from. So it doesn't looks like World War III and Article 5 and all of the big scary trending topics are not in the top 10. Well, Poland still is. Poland's still top 10. Russia's 12 now. World War III is down to 19. Yeah, that was a trend. What was trending on Twitter earlier would have scared you if you would have logged in just a little bit ago, just a few hours ago. I love this. Poland and Germany being on the same side during World War III.
Look at us. Hey, look at us.
Look at us. Huh? Who would have thought?
Not me. Look at us.
Sorry, dark humor. I'm a veteran. Zelensky, Russian missiles hit Poland, constitute attack on collective security. This was posted hours ago from President Zelensky. The latest though, again, NATO is meeting on Wednesday, tomorrow, to likely invoke Article 4. Okay, Article 4, which is basically to just have a discussion about what to do next. When something happens in a NATO country from a non-NATO member, like a missile landing in Poland today, they're having a discussion about what to do next. I think it's important that Biden just came out and said it himself, but also he was very, very strategic with what he said. He said that it was not fired from Russia. Right? Russia, the country within the borders of Russia. Didn't say anything about Russian forces. Russian forces are in Belarus, just north of Ukraine. right? Just north of Ukraine. They launched their invasion, part of their invasion from there. Keep that in mind. So while Biden came out and said, yeah, it wasn't in from Russian borders. There it is right here. A missile that hit Poland is unlikely to have been fired from Russia, U.S. President Joe Biden says. That's what we were just watching, right? We watched him say that. But he said it didn't come from Russian, from Russia, not from Russian forces, which are in Belarus, which is within range of what was hit in Poland. Keep that in mind. Again, Poland's doing their own investigation right now. Poland's words, this was up, let's see if we can get anything new, but right now, no concrete evidence on who fired the missile from the Polish president. Let's see if there's anything brand new. I don't think there's anything new on that. See what we got here. All just commenting on Biden's words right now. Poland, Russian-made missile fell on our country. That's from AP. Nothing new there. Poland considering Article 4 activation, which we already talked about. We went through Article 4 extensively, which again, all NATO decisions are made by consensus after discussion and consultation. So that's basically what Article 4 is, discussion and consultation. They're going to be talking about it, right? They're going to be talking about it. There's still investigations to take place. Just coming out right and saying Russia attacked Poland, I don't think that's the smart thing to say right now. I don't think that's the smart thing to say. But also, there's so many caveats, like Russia immediately denying it. Russia and official media denying it. Any Russian denial, traditionally, damn near every single time since this invasion has began, every denial by Russian sources is an admittance. So they denied it immediately. That's sus. Automatic sus. But Russia, NATO, all of them are on top of it doing an investigation right now. We'll likely learn more after they convene tomorrow with Article 4. And they're going to figure out and get to the bottom of it themselves. Right now, Polish president, not sure. There isn't anything official yet from Poland. Right, they'll be the first ones to report on it. Biden came out and already said, might not be from, or he didn't say that, might not be from a Russian missile. He said it's not from Russia. Are they already twisting what he said? Let's go back to that. Let's go to the source. Hold on. Let's go listen to it one more time. He didn't say anything about a missile, did he? Let's go. Let's listen to it again. Let me turn this thing up. Let's listen to it. This is the original source of what this came from. All right. I'm going to listen to the whole thing again. Let's see if he mentions missile. I don't think he did.
Thanks for being here. As you saw, I just met with the leaders of NATO and the G7 and talked about the latest events in Europe. And I briefed them on my discussions with President Duda of Poland, as well as NATO Secretary General Stoltenberg. And we agreed to support Poland's investigation into the explosion in rural Poland near the Ukrainian border. And I'm going to make sure we figure out exactly what happened. Our empathy simply goes out to apparently two people were killed. And then we're going to collectively determine our next step as we investigate and proceed.
That's what Article 4 is.
Total unanimity among the folks at the table. And we also discussed the latest series of Russian missile attacks, which are continuing the brutality and inhumanity that they've demonstrated throughout this war against Ukrainian cities and civilian infrastructures. And they've been totally unconscionable, what they're doing. Totally unconscionable. And the moment when the world had come together at the G20 to urge de-escalation, Russia continues to, has chosen to escalate in Ukraine while we're meeting. I mean, there were scores and scores of attacks, missile attacks, into Western Ukraine.
That's about Ukraine. Those missile attacks about in Ukrainian borders. He's talking about the strikes on civilian infrastructure today. So that's not about Poland.
We support Ukraine fully in this moment. And we have since the start this conflict. We're going to continue to do whatever it takes to give them the capacity to defend themselves.
Mr. President, too early to say whether this missile was fired from Russia.
Okay, so that reporter asked him, can you say if the missile was fired from Russia? The reporter asked that.
There is preliminary information that contests that. I don't want to say that till we completely investigate but it is. It's unlikely in the minds of the trajectory that it was fired from Russia.
So it sounds like it's fired from Russia, from Russian borders. The trajectory he's talking about from the distance from Russian borders to where it was in Poland, unlikely. But again, Russia has forces in Belarus, which puts it in range. He's being very careful, not saying Russian forces, didn't say Russian military, Russia, firing it from Russian borders.
But we'll see.
We'll see. It keeps it still open for debate because they're going to be talking about it tomorrow. Okay, we can sit here and speculate. We went through a lot of the speculation already from people that are smarter than me with open source intelligence and some of the information that has come out. We already went through all of the available scenarios and all of the available theories about what took place. Right? All right. So we went through what NATO Article 4 is. We went through the theories of what happened. We went through the videos of what happened, which again, there it is. That's the only 3-second clip we have. And then here's a distance shot from Lviv. We're really not going to know the official answer until tomorrow or even Thursday. They're going to discuss it tomorrow about what to do. Investigation will come out. All right, so that's what the whole situation is in Poland. Still unknown. Poland themselves, still unknown. Biden might not be from a Russian missile. Again, I don't know what that's about. He didn't talk about what type of missile it was. He said that it might not be from Russia. And it's anything about if it was a KH-101 or a S-300. United States and NATO allies are investigating the blast. Biden spoke to global leaders. We watched that. Asked about the claims about the blast linked to Russia. Said there's preliminary information that they contest that. I don't want to say until we completely investigate, but unlikely in the lines of trajectory that it was fired from Russia. From the borders of Russia, not Russian military. The U.S. and NATO countries would fully investigate before acting, which is what they're doing, which is the smart thing to do. So NATO Article 4 is going to be enacted or activated. They're going to be meeting on Wednesday, which is today, tomorrow, wherever you're at. It's 9:33 p.m. here on Tuesday night. I know it's Wednesday in some places in Europe now already. So we got to wait for more. Good thing I'm live every single night covering the war. Good thing I'm live every night covering what's going on around the world so you guys can tune back in. Make sure you like and subscribe. All right, before we go, though, don't go anywhere. This is what I usually start the stream with, but when there's breaking news like what happened in Poland today, and I'm just going to do a loose update here. I'm going to record a new one tomorrow sometime if I have time. Probably not because we have the Brooks trial. But here's what's going on in Ukraine since we're talking about it. What's going on in the ground? Here are the four oblasts. I'm just outlining them since I forgot to outline them before I started. But here is the four areas in Ukraine in which there is kinetic activity happening on a daily basis in the last 24 hours, 48 hours. The four oblasts are the Kherson Oblast, the Zaporizhia Oblast, the Donetsk Oblast, and the Luhansk Oblast, from left to right. Kherson, Zaporizhia, Donetsk, and Luhansk. That's all outlined here in the green. The three areas we're going to be focusing on, though, within these four, the three areas we're going to be focusing on is going to be the Ukrainian counteroffensive here in the northeast between Kharkiv and Luhansk, the Russian offensive in the east in Donetsk. And then there really hasn't been a whole lot to update, but we'll just touch on it so you know where things are here in the southern axis, in the Kherson Oblast, and what's going on there with the liberations, okay? We're going to start with the northeast and Ukraine's counteroffensives there and what it's looking like. Lots of Ukrainian success. We're going to be seeing some more liberations here as well. Let's take a look up here. Because beyond everything, Ukraine's military is still advancing. They're still ongoing. So they're clearing. Right now, this is what we're looking at. Here's the front line. I get too ahead of myself here every single time because there's just so much. And the map isn't wanting to load all the way. So that's great. There we go. All right. So here's the front line from Kupiansk down to the city of Siversk. Massive front line, about 130 kilometers. Other cities that are important here, Borova and Lyman. These are the front line cities along this Ukrainian counteroffensive here. Okay, you got the Ukrainian armed forces that still are advancing. And right now the success is clearing out area, clearing Russians out along this N26 highway, this key ground line of communication. Huge, right? So here is the key ground line of communication that connects to the Russian-occupied city of Svatova. Real quick, let me draw that on the map. Ukraine, look at how much space they've liberated along this highway. The purple is highway. Huge. And then they just have this little sliver here of space. Let's zoom in there. Let's zoom in on what we're seeing here. So they only have just this little sliver of space left to liberate along this highway in the village of Novosilvetsky. So Ukrainians are surrounding the village here. You can clearly see it. They liberated completely the village of Krivoshivka. The village of Krivoshivka, they're doing the Thunder Run flanking maneuver here around the villages along this this ground line of communication. So the Ukrainians are going to have lots of space along this ground line of communication liberated very, very soon. Again, this is well into Luhansk. The next two cities that are going to be liberated by Ukrainian armed forces is Svatova and Kremina. Likely Kremina first. They're getting so close to the city now. They're getting so close to the city of Kremina. So let's go down to there. There haven't been a whole lot of updates between Kupiansk and Borova. They're still trying to liberate space here around these villages. It's just a lot of mud, a lot of fields here. It's just lots of not a lot of city between these villages here and the next villages on the other side of this highway. So it's just a lot of the terrain is causing Ukrainian forces to slow down and continue getting closer to Svatova here. But around Kremina, just north of Siversk, you have the Ukrainians that are advancing into the village of Kuzmin. Right, that's the village that's right on the outskirts of Kremina. They're encircling the Russians in this space here in the city of Kremina, which is still under Russian control in Luhansk. The Ukrainians are surrounding them and are advancing towards that city. We're likely going to see this city liberated before Svatova, but again, Ukrainian armed forces are seeing a massive or immense success here in the northeast. So that's basically all to update with the Ukrainian counteroffensive. I update every day, so if there's major changes, I'll let you guys know. But that's about it here for the northeastern counteroffensive within Ukraine at this time. Next is going to be the Russian offensive. So that was Ukrainian counteroffensive. This is the Russian offensive within Ukraine around Bakhmut. Hasn't been a whole lot to update here either. The latest is going to be the Ukrainian success around the city. So here's the Ukrainian-controlled city of Bakhmut. They've recently had success liberating territory around the outskirts of the city to the south and to the east, and they're pushing even further northeastward along the key ground line of communication, the T1302 highway that connects Bakhmut to Lysychansk and Severodonetsk all the way to the Kremina and to Svatova and to Kupiansk. It's crucial. The more supply line they cut off of the Russians, the more likely we're going to see the Russians fall back into the separatist region faster. Every time the Ukrainians cut the Russians off and their supply lines, they fold. They did it in this massive Ukrainian counteroffensive in Kharkiv, what we're seeing still ongoing. But in September, that was the massive success that we saw. They cut Russian supplies off. Just like we're seeing down here in the south, in Kherson, they cut the Russian supplies off. They weren't going to be able to resupply the Russians. They were going to be screwed in the wintertime. So the Ukrainian military forced the Russians to retreat. Otherwise, they would have had massive tens of thousands of soldiers being killed beyond what they're already seeing. So we're seeing the supply lines being cut. They're still working on this here, even in the Russian offensive. And that's basically it to report here. Here in Advika, just outside the Russian-occupied city of Donetsk, there just hasn't been any changes beyond them losing some territory in Pitsky and in Marinka. So the Russians have actually lost some territory in some of the key villages just outside of Donetsk, but they've also gained some territory around Advika, just on the outskirts of the town. There hasn't been much else to update with that situation. Also here in the southern axis of Ukraine, so that was the Russian offensive. The Ukrainian armed forces are seeing some successes there. But now here in the southern axis of Ukraine, Not just some successes, we're seeing massive successes from the Ukrainian military as they've liberated the city of Kherson, and that was the biggest news before what has transpired today in Poland and what's transpired all across the country. And the missile strikes is going to be the liberation of the city of Kherson. We have preliminary reports that the Ukrainian armed forces have crossed the river into the left bank of the Dnipro River, but today there hasn't been anything. All of the reports have been focused around Poland. So there just hasn't been any open source intelligence reporting of anything further. You got some, again, this is the closest to some map correction of the Ukrainians crossing the river. And you can see here, this is under Ukrainian control. And we do have preliminary reports that they crossed here into the city of Opitny. That's just across the river of Kherson. But beyond that, not a whole lot today, territorial change-wise. Majority of the territorial changes are up here in the northeast with Ukraine's counteroffensive, because this is ongoing. We're tracking that every day. We're ongoing here, but again, the majority of the news came from Poland. I'll mark that real quick so you see where that is. That's about right here. It's about right there in Poland. There it is on the Google Maps. So you can see how far away that is from the front lines within Ukraine. You can see it's pretty far away from the front lines. The Russians are getting pushed further and further back. So while Biden's statement that it likely didn't come from Russian territory, let me use red. It likely didn't come from Russian borders here. This is the Russian border. Russia launched their invasion from Belarus. Russia had troops right up in here. So it could have came from here very easily. Sure, couldn't have came from Russian borders if that's what you're going with. But Russia has troops stationed up here in Belarus. Ukraine is actively building defensive positions and defensive capabilities around in the Kyiv Oblast for a potential Russian invasion again from Belarus southward, another wave of Russian proxy forces. They're preparing for that. They're preparing for that to take place. So a strike from Belarus isn't completely off the table, but that's again for NATO to investigate. Poland's investigating it. They're going into it. It's happening. Okay. We'll wait for more on that tomorrow. If you want more from me tonight, though, I'm still going to be live tonight as I always am. As I always am here on YouTube. If you're interested, come on over to Snack Squad TV. We're still playing God of War. God of War Ragnarok, Game of the Year. All right. If you want to chill out, where am I? I'm not even on here. Let me pull it up. I don't even have it on the right screen. There we go. Apologies. If you want to come hang out on my gaming channel, Snack Squad TV, part 6. Of our God of War playthrough. I'm going to redirect the YouTube stream right into it anyways. But if you're watching on Facebook and you want to kind of chill out, because I know this news is scary with Article 5 and NATO having to do talks now and Russia's escalations that are ongoing, I know it's scary. Come on and hang out with the Snack Squad. We're a chill community. We keep it chill. You already know I'm going to cover what's going on anyway. So gaming, or whether I'm covering news, it's the same community. We just do video games as well. Not as big of an audience, but if you're interested, come on over and hang out. I read all the comments and interact. Plus, this game is a good escape from reality right now. It's Myth and Legends. It's great. The story's amazing. Come on and hang out with us. I play single-player story games. Tomorrow, Warzone 2.0 comes out. So after the war coverage, I'm going to be streaming the new Warzone. And if you play Warzone, you can come and team up with me and we can play and try to keep my news interactive. I'm a real person. I'm not a pundit. I'm not a mouthpiece for anybody but myself. This is an independent news, so I know it's scary news at times, and I care that you guys aren't freaking the fuck out and making cult dichotomies about and being fearful about every single thing that happens. You don't have to be, okay? So come and hang out with the Snack Squad if you're interested. Otherwise, tomorrow we have more from Mercado Media. More from Mercado Media. The Daryl Brooks trial is finishing up, the final. It's already scheduled. So maybe video games aren't your thing. That's okay. We got more coverage tomorrow here with the Daryl Brooks trial, the final day 2 sentencing at noon Central Time, 1 p.m. Eastern, and then tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, like we do every single night, the Ukraine War Streamcast will be back here on Mercado Media. So thank you guys again for tuning in. I'm independent news, independent media here completely. 420 friendly stream. Thank you guys again for tuning in here, for all the super chats and super stickers, all of the support. I'm going to try to hit up Operator Starsky again here soon and have him come back on so we can get some Ukrainian perspective of what's been taking place, from the missile attacks throughout the country to some analysis on what's been taking place in Poland. I'll see if we can have him back on at some point this week and chat. So thank you guys again so much. Like the video if you enjoy this content. Make sure you subscribe to the YouTube channel. Make sure you're following us on Facebook and you have notifications turned on there as well. Have a good night, everybody. Also, if you're watching the stream after the fact, leave a comment below. I do read all post stream comments. So if you rewatch the stream or if you watch this after it posts, I read all the comments and respond to them. So thank you again for supporting the channel with your view. Take care, you guys. Have a good one. See you tomorrow.